This moment, Ray, 43 of the world's best stock car drivers sit alone with their thoughts as we go down to the grid for the command.
And now, for the most famous words in auto racing, Mr. Jim White.
Gentlemen, start your engine.
I'm Jerry Punch, and we are glad to have you with us today here at Talladega. You know, if you were to take the NASCAR record book and flip to the page on most competitive races, you would learn very quickly that four of the five most competitive races in the history of the sport have happened right here at Talladega. Back in 1984, we saw a NASCAR record 75 lead changes, and 2 years later, over half the field, 26 drivers, led this race. Now, given the rule changes this week and what we're hearing from the garage area, they hope that the headlines tomorrow around this country will read, at Talladega, grown men use slingshots to bring the fans to their feet. Well, let's hear what our experts think. Let's bring in our champions and my heroes. Here's Benny Parsons and Ned Jarrett.
You know, since 1969, they've been racing at Talladega. They've averaged over 35 lead changes per race. But you got to go back to 1989 to find a number larger than 35. So the last 11 years, 25 lead changes. That's what NASCAR is trying to do, is to try to increase drag, make passing a little bit easier so we can see a lot more lead changes.
And I think we will, Ben. The happy hour yesterday was any indication. We saw a lot of three and four wide drafting out there, and also it was easier for the drivers to pass. You know, in the past, on the last lap, you wanted to be in the lead, at least for the last 5 or 6 years. But now they say that the lead car is going to be the sitting duck. We'll see at the end of this race.
Well, guys, if anticipation by fans and drivers alike means anything, this one today will be one to remember. I hope you put seatbelts on your sofa, because now it's time to strap it at home for hopefully the ride of a lifetime, Talladega Super Speedway style. As ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports, once again brings you NASCAR. Today, live from the world's fastest stock car facility, 500 miles of high bank, high speed action. ESPN coverage of exciting NASCAR action from Talladega, Alabama is being brought to you by Valvoline MaxLife, the first motor oil formulated for higher mileage engines. by Ford F-Series. The best-selling trucks are built Ford tough. And by brand name tires, oil changes, and more at your neighborhood Walmart Tire and Lube Express. Take a look at this massive facility, 2,500 acres, Talladega Super Speedway, 2.66 miles around. The front straightaway, 4,300 feet. That's because of the trioval. On the back stretch, a straight 4,000-foot drag strip. The corners banked at 33 degrees, the trioval 18, and the straightaway, the back straightaway, just 2 degrees. Let's take a look now at our Walmart Tire and Lube Express starting grid and show you that Front Row Joe picked up his first pole of the year, his sixth of his career, and the second year in a row he is set on the pole for this event at Talladega. He is flanked by Awesome Bill, Bill Elliott, who started second here back in April. Back in row two, Rookie of the Year candidate Dale Earnhardt Jr., a two-time winner but yet to win on a plate track, will be inside of row two, and Jerry Nadeau brings the Michael Holligan Chevrolet to the outside. We'll be riding along on the Budweiser onboard camera with Dale Earnhardt Jr. throughout the afternoon. Back in row three, it's an old Joe Gibbs row. Sensational sophomore Tony Stewart has the Home Depot Pontiac, winner of two of the last three events in NASCAR. And beside him, his teammate and current Winston Cup points leader, Bobby Labonte, the Interstate Batteries Pontiac. And we'll be riding along on the Circuit City onboard camera with Bobby all afternoon. All right, our next row, Kenny Wallace on the inside, looking for Hurst for fifth, first Winston Cup win in the Square D Chevrolet. And beside him, Jeff Gordon will go to the back of the pack after a problem having to go to a backup car yesterday. How about the oldest driver in the field, Dave Marcus, 59 years of age, brings the Realtree Chevy inside of row five. And beside him, the first of five Noble Five candidates is Steve Park.
And in row number six, it's an all Robert Yates Racing, with Ricky Rudd and Dale Jarrett. Making up row six, row seven, we see Stacy Compton and Ken Schrader. In row number eight, John Andretti and Kevin LePage. Row number nine, we see Terry Labonte, a former winner here, former Winston Cup champion, and Michael Waltrip. Row 10, Bobby Hamilton and Dale Earnhardt, the defending champion of the Winston 500.
On the inside of row 11 is Ward Burton. On the outside, Jimmy Spencer. And we ride along with Ward Burton this afternoon, the Husqvarna onboard camera. In row 12, on the inside is Johnny Benson. On the outside, Mike Skinner. And Skinner will let us ride around with him on board the Lowe's Chevrolet. On the inside of row 13, Elliott Sadler. And the fastest qualifier in second round, Richie Craven on the outside. In row 14, on the inside, the Valvoline Ford Mark Martin, Rich Bickle on the outside. And once again, Mark Martin allows us to be on board with him in his Valvoline Ford. And in row 15, on the inside, Rick Mast. On the outside, Ted Musgrave.
Back in row 16, Steve Grissom drives the Hot Wheels Pontiac, flanked by Sterling Marlin, the Coors Light Chevrolet. Back in row 17, rookie Dave Blaney, alongside three-time Winston Cup champion Darrell Waltrip, his 55th and final start at Talladega. Next row, rookie Scott Pruitt in the tied Ford, flanked by leading Rookie of the Year contender Matt Kenseth. In the next row, Jeff Burton will have the Citgo Superguard Ford in 37th starting spot. And beside him is Rusty Wallace, the Miller Lite Ford. We'll ride along with Jeff Burton on the Parts Plus onboard camera. And, of course, Rusty Wallace, the onboard camera, the Miller Lite Ford roof camera for Rusty, looking for his first restrictor plate race win. Next row, Chad Little making his final start in the John Deere Ford. And beside him, Jeremy Mayfield in the Mobil 1 Ford for Roger Penske. We'll ride along with Jeremy from the back of the pack in 40th starting spot and watch him come through traffic throughout the day. And the final starter today, Robert Presley will start 41st in the Jasper Engines Ford, flanked by Brett Bodine in the Ralph Supermarkets Ford Taurus. And starting 43rd in shotgun on the field, former USAC Silver Crown champion, the Pfizer Viagra Pontiac for Milwaukee, Oregon driver Mike Blitz. Now, among those drivers that did not qualify here, Wally Dahlenbach, Blaze Alexander, and Hut Strickland. Just three drivers and three cars missing the starting field here for this Winston 500 presented by UPS. Our race analysis showed you this one's 188 laps, 500 miles, the largest purse in the history of the Winston 500, $2.795 million. The pit window, well, that's got to be a little bit of a question mark, Benny, as to how far they can go. Not a lot of time in happy hour to determine that. There's the race record. Ernie Irvin set it just a few years back. Back with the green flag from Talladega Super Speedway in just a moment.
out there, 55 to 62?
Yeah. What do you think?
Oh, I'd say 45 to 52.
Really?
I don't think they won't get near the mileage with the bigger difference and with the drag that they got.
Yeah. He's going to the back.
Going to the back of the pack, Mikey.
Going to the back up, you big idiot. Where have you been this whole time?
Glad to have you join us, Mikey. Oh, no. Oh, goodness. Goodness. Great open, guys. Way to get him in the truck. Go after him downstairs, guys. Kick the tires and light the fires.
Nelson, did Rick Humphrey, did you ever see him? Who is it, Max Life or something?
Sorry.
Best we can, man, is have a good one.
Right.
And we're set.
Super Speedway on a beautiful afternoon, getting set for the start. Let's check in quickly with a situation updating the Earnhardt crew chief problem. Bill Weber?
Well, Kevin Hamlin is the crew chief for Dale Earnhardt. Last night, he was a driver in an exhibition monster truck race here at Talladega. You can see he is seated in the pit area today. That is because last night, he has a compression fracture of the vertebrae in his back. So he's in a great deal of pain, but is in the pit area today. We'll work with Earnhardt on the radio. When Earnhardt rolled down pit road, he asked him how that truck driver is doing. And Kevin goes, that's ex-truck driver. All Earnhardt wanted to know is if he won. He said, I did.
I hope there are seat belts on Kevin Hamlin's seat because he's going to need it to watch this one today. Folks, glad to have you with us. Almost 170,000 strong in the stands to watch the 32nd running of the Winston 500. Pro Joe and Awesome Bill lead him down. 43 of the world's best stock car drivers ready to get on here at Talladega.
Check our pole sitter already in the middle, already back to about 12, 14, 15, and losing positions every yard, it seems.
He knew that he was going to be a sitting duck, and certainly he was. When Dale Earnhardt Jr. made that move down to the inside, everybody went by on each side.
He told our pit reporters during NASCAR today that he would have no shot leading that first lap, and indeed he was right. As here comes that big Budweiser Chevrolet for Dale Earnhardt Jr. Couple of young drivers looking at NASCAR's future, Earnhardt Jr. and Tony Stewart, head for the trial, and they will lead the first lap, first and second, but they are side by side from there on back.
Now trying to move up on the outside of Tony Stewart. Of course, he has a fast car. He qualified on the outside pole. If he can get a little help back there, he wants to move to the front.
And here comes Tony Stewart, the battle for the lead. They're three wide. Going in turn three, Kenny Wallace helping Tony Stewart.
And they will hang Dale Earnhardt Jr. out to dry. He's in the middle, and he will go backsliding. Has no drafting partners. As Stewart will try to lead lap number two. Well, two laps, two different leaders.
Now we see the 31 of Mike Skinner, the 9 car of Stacy Compton in the middle.
And Dave Marcus goes up and takes the lead. Dave Marcus led a lap at Talladega. Wow, look at him go.
59-year-old Dave Marcus in the Real Tree Chevrolet. His best qualifying effort of the year. He started ninth. And has he come to the front in a hurry? But now even he gets shuffled back. As here comes Tony Stewart with a whole line behind him, including Dale Jarrett, John Andretti, and Michael Walsh.
Four wide back in the pack there. There you see it on your screen. Still four wide portions of the racetrack.
Lap. Marcus led lap two. Looks like Tony Stewart will lead lap number three. Folks, you got 188 laps. At this rate, we're going to have a record. And here goes John Andretti after the lead.
Andretti made a neat move down on the inside of Dale Jarrett coming off of turn four. Shot him all the way up there. Now he's running the lead.
And meanwhile, behind Dale Earnhardt is back in second spot. I'm trying to see who that car is in front. Where did Michael Walter come from? That's a new country heard from.
Now three leaders, three different laps. Let's see if Michael Walter. Here's Michael Walter trying to hold on to the inside. Earnhardt, that big orange three on his roof indicated he's one of the Nobel Five drivers. Three wide. Ricky Rudd almost out on the inside. He is on the bottom. Junior and Elliott on the outside.
And is Michael going to lead that lap? No. Tony Stewart. Tommy Hamilton, the four car, starting back in 19th, has moved his way up into second. And here comes Andretti up on the outside. They've got Michael Waltrip in the middle. And Junior's hooked up with the 43 of John Andretti.
Boy, in the past races here, at least the last two or three, that inside groove, I mean, the middle groove was not too bad, but today it doesn't look to be too good. Once you get in there, they just move the motor right on by you on either side.
And right now, Andretti and Dale Earnhardt Jr. not making a lot of progress from the outside.
That inside groove now with Tony Stewart, Pontiac Chevrolet, a pair of Pontiacs. Back in fifth position. Big Texaco star for Rudd. Dale Jarrett is backslid now. He's leading that middle pack in the middle group. There's DJ in the car number 88, leading the draft with Kenny Wallace and Sterling Marlin. Now, right along with our point leader, Bobby Labonte, the Circuit City on. Bobby started in sixth spot, has slid back to 15th position.
And there's Jeff Gordon on the inside, who started dead last. Last time by, Gordon was running about 15th.
He said he had a good race car, and he's certainly proving that he does have.
He's just going to squad along with Bobby Labonte. Look up at Jeff Gordon. He lost his primary car at the beginning of happy hour when a broken left front shock ripped the fender away and part of the tire. He saved the car, but they had to go to a backup car. This is the car he started 36 with and won here in April at Talladega.
Bobby Labonte backed off the throttle. Did you see that, Ned? The cars are closing in and out. They had to back off the accelerator.
I talked to Larry McReynolds yesterday after happy hour. He said, I've never even been concerned to see any brake dust after happy hour. But he said, I saw a lot of it on cars here after happy hour, but they were running up so fast on the other cars that they had to put their brakes on.
Now they are three wide all around this racetrack, Benny.
That gives Fisher cut caught in the middle. We have driving help from Kevin LePage. Behind him, there's Ricky Craven. And that's what they're talking about by being so dependent. When you talk to these drivers, they all realize they're just so dependent on other drivers not to make a mistake, not slip up into them and make contact. Because once a car starts spinning you, you can see that you can involve 20 cars without any problem at all.
Now, there are seven cars in a lead pack single file. But in years past, these seven cars would pull away very, very quickly from these guys running side by side. But that has not happened now. This second pack trying to hang on. Michael Walters was going for the lead about five laps ago then, and now he is back leading that second pack.
Yeah, but he'll catch up in a hurry here when we see those cars getting side by side up in front of them. They're trying to get around Earnhardt. They'll open up a big hole of air there, and that's going to allow Michael Walters to make Okay, see, that's what they did. Just a half a lap.
And see, Earnhardt tried to pass Ricky Rudd, and those two cars got side by side. Look how quickly the other car caught, but look how quickly those front cars drove away from it.
Let's check in the Earnhardt pits with Bill Weber.
Word around here is dirty air. A lot of turbulent air created by the new aerodynamic packages on these cars. It is so turbulent out there in the draft that the plastic sheet that was on Earnhardt's windshield that they used to tear off during the race so he gets a clean windshield was ripped off by the turbulent air. He radioed in, said, "You don't need to take it off. It's already gone."
Wow. Now, how about a father and son hookup? Earnhardt Jr. pushing his dad down the straightaway. Can he push him to the lead? Right now they're back in about ninth or tenth position.
It's like hanging on that rope when you get to the corner. You want to let go, and he had to let go. When he got his dad down the corner, you can't push the car straight in the corner you've got now. As he gets on the straightaway, here's a good spot. He moves up, and I'm sure he's going to be touching the rear bumper of his dad's car.
You just saw him bump him a moment ago. That part of that orange rear spoiler indicates Earnhardt Sr., one of those for the Noble 5 million. Elliott Sadler down on the inside in that Citgo Ford. Out of the Woodrunner stable.
The outside line is just not going, Ned, like we've seen it in the past.
No, it isn't. That's a little bit surprising, Ben, of course, to know that the inside line is the shortest way around the racetrack. But right now, that inside line does appear to be a little bit faster. Jeff Gordon, as you mentioned, is going all the way up from the rear of the field and up there running now in the 10th position, content to hang on to Dale Jarrett down that inside line. And looking at they'll get a chance to make some passes here. Bill Elliott makes a move.
As you watch Bill Elliott make his move, how many times this year have we said, as Awesome Bill makes a move back in line, that sensational sophomore Tony Stewart is leading today in NASCAR Winston Cup competition. The Home Depot colors of Joe Gibbs Racing Team showing the way after 10 of 188 laps are complete. We'll be right back. Racing as they are three wide, and now that middle groove beginning to work a little bit, as well as the outside.
Well, Jeff Gordon moved up on the outside and really made that outside groove come into play. As a matter of fact, he's moved all the way to the front.
Unbelievable, Benny. Jeff Gordon starts 43rd and has passed 42 cars, and here on lap number 13, it looks like he will lead this race. Now, he actually qualified eighth at the top of the back of the field. The green flag, and now look at this. What an effort.
On board the low Chevrolet of Mike Skinner, caught in the middle. He's been there for about 10 laps now. He works his way forward, and then something will happen. He goes backwards. Jerry Nadeau was in second spot just a moment ago, and Earnhardt goes for the lead.
Nine-time winner at Talladega. He won both events in 1999. He won this race from 27th starting spot. And the Intimidator, look at these fans on their feet waving those hats. That's what it's all about. They want to see him on their feet screaming and waving as Earnhardt leads Ward Burton. But here comes Gordon with some drafting help on the outside. Will Earnhardt lead this lap? Yes, he will.
Skinner is still in the middle, but he's about sixth or seventh position right now and has a car behind him.
Well, we saw the 88 car up toward the front about five or six laps ago. Now he has dropped back significantly. Ray Dunlap, what's the problem?
Well, Jerry, after they started 12th, PJ said the car was pretty good, but all of a sudden the water temperature started going up. A lot of these guys have these cars taped off a lot in the front to try to get aerodynamics. So with that temperature going up into the 230 range, they decided they needed to get out and get some more air. So DJ dropped back a little bit so that he could be out of traffic. I think the exact same thing is what's going on with Bobby Labonte. So a couple of these guys with cars that are getting very, very warm.
Earnhardt is leading, and you got to remember, Bobby Labonte is our points leader. There's five events remaining, four after today. Dale Jarrett also in the contention. He's back and forth in the points, so that could be huge This is one of those big hurdles that they had to get over there. We talked about all week long. Now, meanwhile, back up front, Dale Earnhardt Sr. showing the way. Let's check in his pitch again with Bill.
Jerry, just to follow up, Ray just said that's why the three car got in the outside lane a few laps ago. Earnhardt's temps were going up. He called in, I got to get out and get some air. If he's in front, he gets plenty of air. John?
Well, Ray Dunlap was absolutely right about Bobby Labonte running just a little bit warm. 205 on the water, 230 on the oil. Drop back, tried to get some more air into that front opening, which is very, very small, trying to keep the car cool, keep the engine cool.
See how far he's staying back behind the 88 car, and the 88 car is staying pretty far back behind the car in front of him, so they can get as much clean, fresh air as possible.
You say, well, why do they put the tape on the grill if the car is going to run warm? Because the more tape you can run on the grill, the faster the car will run, because any air that goes in, hits the radiator, hits the engine, will slow the car down. But you have to get it right. You have to keep the water temperature around 200 degrees with as much tape as you possibly can.
Back up front, there's the line, there's the conga line. They try to break each other's draft, but now with that huge hole, these cars punching the wind with NASCAR's rule changes. What NASCAR effectively did this year week was try to add about 100 horsepower equivalent of drag to these cars, opening up the restrictor plate initially to 1 inch, now dropping it back to 15/16, so they have slowed them down here at Talladega, but they have given the drivers throttle response.
Yes, they have, and they like that, and as a result, we've seen the passing that we have. Jerry, I looked on the scoreboard after about the third lap, and the 43rd place car was a little over 4 seconds behind the leader. Right now, the last lap around, Chad Little, who is running 43rd, is 4.7 seconds behind the leader, so it hasn't changed a lot.
How about that? NASCAR wanted to keep them together. The drivers wanted better racing. The fans wanted a better show. I believe we've accomplished that so far, as we are 18 laps in it, and we've had five different leaders. As that outside line, though, here comes Mike Skinner with a little help from his friends, Jeff Gordon and company, Gary Nadeau, and see if Skinner can lead.
Well, he had a run coming down through the trial, and Skinner is in the lead now. Can he lead when he get back to the start-finish line? In fact, it's showing that he was the leader when he came across the start-finish line.
Skinner, his best finish of this year, came here in April. He actually finished right behind the guy who's chasing him right now, Jeff Gordon.
We've got a lot of Chevrolets up front here right now, and a lot of them thought with the 1-inch restrictor plate that maybe the Chevrolets had a little bit of an advantage. And after the 15-16, some of the Chevrolet drivers and teams were saying, hey, that hurt us more than it did before. But right now, Benny, there are 8 Chevrolets out front of the first four to Bill Elliott.
Yeah, well, what the Chevrolets are going to have out in the morning. The Chevrolets have a 2-inch smaller, more narrow rear spoiler than the Fords and Pontiacs. And everyone was just screaming about what a Chevrolet runaway was going to be here at Talladega.
And Kevin LePage apparently having a problem at FamilyClick.com Ford Taurus. He's waving to the driver behind him as he slows. On that back straight, we'll be headed to pit road to Pat Tryson and his crew to see if they can determine what the problem may be.
Last time by, Kevin LePage was running in the 11th position.
And we understand that maybe it's an engine. You wonder if he had that overheating problem and stayed out there and kept running. But now he's headed to the pit.
All right, Mike Skinner becomes our sixth different leader here at Talladega. And the Lowe's Chevrolet driver trying to get his first victory in his 140th start. Back with more from Talladega in just a moment.
I might have been a little strong there, but I'm not going to be nearly strong. Some of those comments are going to be after the race.
You're exactly right.
That's something that you didn't touch on in NASCAR today that you should have. No.
We probably should mention when you say Chevrolets, you probably should mention that those were all, the top eight were General Motors, because there were like three Pontiacs in there.
Good point.
Smaller. Never touched on it. Hmm.
Daytona Super Speedway. We left you a moment ago. Mike Skinner was the leader. That didn't last for long, about two laps. And then the 24 car, Jeff Gordon, came around Skinner. And then the inside pack, led by Dale Earnhardt, has now come back by, and Earnhardt leads. We have had eight lead changes so far among six different drivers. And we are just 24 laps in to the Winston 500.
Still running four abreast at times. There you see two packs of three abreast.
So it might be Dave Marcus back in the middle of that pack.
Mm-hmm.
Meanwhile, Earnhardt still leading the group on the inside. Jeff Gordon leading the group on the outside.
As you watch these two packs still riding side by side, single file. Let's check in the Kevin LePage pit with Ray.
Well, Jerry, it wasn't a tape-off problem on the front of the number 16. They didn't have much tape on the front at all. Kevin radioed in and said, I lost oil pressure, so he shut it off. They're behind the wall right now taking a look at it. They don't know if it's terminal or not, but it was oil pressure, not water temperature.
Kevin LePage, the first to retire here, the 43 starters.
If that gauge read zero on the oil pressure, he's got a problem, and I'm sure, pretty sure it's terminal.
Take a look, Bill Elliott now, the first Ford we see toward the front of the field. He's in that inside line in fourth position.
He was, Bill was, when I mentioned that a moment ago about the GM cars, I should have said GM cars, not the Chevrolets, because there are some Pontiacs in that mix up front there. But Bill Elliott was ninth at that time. Now he's moved up to sixth. And there's the last place car, that 97 of Chad Little. And he's still only 4.6 seconds behind the leader.
Now see the 99, the 17, and the 97. Three of the Jack Roush cars back running in the 40th, 42nd. 41st and 42nd position.
Dale Earnhardt continuing to lead here at Talladega. Goodrich Chevrolet behind him, the Caterpillar Pontiac. On the inside of the DuPont Chevy of Jeff Gordon, who's riding along now on the closed roof camera with Mike Skinner. Started to say a moment ago, Bill Elliott. Hard to believe Bill Elliott has not won in 188 races. His last win came in September of 1994 at Darlington, but that could change today. And now back to our points leader.
Bobby Labonte is now running in the third position. He and Dale Jarrett were back three or four spots back winning there.
They were 35th and 36th about three laps ago. Now they're beginning to move up a little bit.
Still getting some space between themselves and the car in front of them. Prime. Now it looks like that Gordon and Skinner got a good run. Not enough to get on the outside and challenge Earnhardt.
Well, Earnhardt's found in a situation there that's really working for him right now.
Look to the outside there. Ricky Craven in the Midwest Transit car number 50 right in front of Kenny Schrader. They have been basically glued together on that high line.
Whoa, Bill Elliott all the way down below the yellow line had to back out of it. He was very fortunate there that others behind him would observe it and didn't try to crowd and gave him room to back out of it and get back behind him.
Tony Stewart had to make an evasive move to go by Bill Elliott as now Jeff Gordon goes to the front. Two cars are within 4.5 seconds of each other.
And we see the 40 car, Sterling Marlin, positioned on the outside of the 25, kind of pushes Nadeau down to the middle. He closes up on the back bump of Skinner. He's going to try it on the outside of Skinner, but could not quite make it. Prefer to make that move on the outside because the wall is a lot closer to the outside line than it is the inside line. In case you have a problem, go and smack the wall. You don't have far to go. It doesn't hurt quite as much. And look how much that Jeff Gordon, how much space he lost since the last time by to that inside line.
Mike Skinner came down behind Ricky Rudd. That's why he caught that middle, man. He realized that inside line has been the place to be.
Yes, the middle group has not been the place to be so far in this race, and that's a little bit surprising that he found out very quickly that he was going towards the back, and so as soon as he got an opportunity to fall in there behind Ricky Rudd, he took that opportunity.
Well, we have 29 laps.
the books at Talladega with Earnhardt, Burton, Stewart, Elliott run the top five, and many of these fans have yet to sit down. We'll be right back.
And there's Jeremy Mayfield right in the middle. A three wide behind the red, white, and blue car. That is the 12 of Jeremy Mayfield. Looking back at Sterling Marlin. You see Dale Jarrett on his on the right side of the screen. And look at this, 193 miles per hour. He just squeezed out the car just a little bit.
Jeremy Mayfield started back in 40th position. Roger Penske on mobile 1-4.
See that inside during this moving line is moving there right now. Johnny Benson goes by some cars.
Jeff Gordon had dropped back to 20th spot from the outside line. Worked his way to the middle line and out of the inside line. Now worked his way back toward the front of the inside line.
Well, he's going to, when this race is over, Jeff Gordon's going to know exactly how his car handles in every position because he's going to be in most of them.
He's already been in a lot of different positions. Certainly been in a lot of traffic.
Now, we showed you the Roush cars toward the back of the pack, including Jeff Burton, the guy second in points. What's going on with him, Bill Weber?
Well, Jerry, that's Jeff Burton, a.k.a. Captain Provisional. I tried to get a straight answer out of Frank Stoddard, his crew chief. I said, you're still way in the back. He goes, what are you talking about? We're 3 seconds behind the leader. But what he said is it's an L.A. traffic jam in front of us. We're waiting for the traffic cop to wave us through. But in reality, this appears to be part of a plan because Burton just called in, and he not only talked to Frank Stoddard, but he talked to Robbie Reiser, who's the crew chief for Mack Kenseth, and said, have Mack close up a little bit. We don't want to lose these guys in front of us. And pick up positions when they pick. Right now, they think it's safer where they're at, but they are not frustrated. This is part of a plan. They're doing okay.
Well, thanks, Bill. We'll keep an eye on those Roush Kateer toward the back of the pack there with Robbie Reiser and Jeff Burton running toward the back. Meanwhile, Dale Earnhardt in the Goodman Chevrolet. Seven-time Winston Cup champion and Mr. Restrictor Plate, Dale Earnhardt Sr., leading the way at Talladega. 10 wins in Restrictor Plate competition, and Earnhardt showing them how to get it done after 36 laps. Back in just a moment. Well, Earnhardt was pissed about them making this plate smaller because it wasn't going to make him very successful. I hate to think what happened if they left that thing at an inch.
Yeah.
Wow, look at this.
Now that's dangerous.
Hey, Mikey, these fans behind the flag stand, not up here in the tower, but the lower section, have not sat down yet. They are unbelievable. They're all still standing. That's incredible. In the lower section.
Well, that's because the people in front, Jerry, won't sit down, and they can't see.
Okay, well,
sitting up.
What's that? I'm not looking for it. I got it right here. I'm hard over this. Sunday night, NFL, 8:30 Eastern. Okay.
Got hit a high note, didn't
he? Okay. Sunday night football coming in at 8:30 Eastern with a matchup of the quarterbacks in the class of 99. Dante Culpepper in the first place. Minnesota Vikings head to the Windy City to battle Cade McNown and the Chicago Bears. It all begins at 7:30 with primetime. NFL tonight, 8:30 Eastern.
Well, the powerhouse in the NFL, and how about Mr. Earnhardt, Mr. Restrictor Plate? What a powerhouse he is at Daytona and Talladega.
10 wins at these two racetracks, 31 top fives, and he just goes on over 2,000 laps led, and he keeps adding to that, make it 2,085 right now. We can't do that, but he just keeps adding to that total. Ooh, Bobby Hamilton up on the outside was four wide as he goes down the corner. And he's just up on the outside and he comes off the corner. There's still, looks like about four wide. The pole sitter, Joe Nemechek, trying to fight his way back to the front. There he is right in the middle of the 33 car. And right now, the last time they were shown, in 19th, but I think he's probably about 15th now.
Wallace in the Miller Lite Ford Taurus. Wrecking heavy traffic, sorry.
Wrecking started in 38th position, and he's now up in 22nd, so he's gained 16 spots, but Bill Elliott.
Bill's got a run here on the outside.
Dale side by side through the banking. Earnhardt trying to hold off. Awesome Bill. And Bill looks like he'll get a little bit of a drafting push, maybe from Earnhardt Jr. As you watch this side-by-side action, let's check in with Ray Dunlap.
Well, Jerry, part of the reason we're seeing a lot of passing here is there's a lot of cars with different rear-end gear ratios because they weren't sure what this plate was going to do. We've got a variable all the way from about a 294 up to a 315 rear gear. Now, what that does is it's going to change how fast you can come down pit road. Depending on what gear you're in, which most guys come down pit road in second gear, your variable will be about 3,500 to 3,700. But Robert Yates just got on the radio and told Dale Jarrett, why don't you try using first gear coming down pit road? It'll help get you here a lot quicker. He's got to keep his track at about 5,300 RPM. So the rear end gear is certainly a big issue here, and a lot of cars trying different strategies.
That's certainly something to consider as the day goes on, particularly talking about fuel mileage and guys who may be moving in on some pit stops. If you watch Bill Elliott, who became our seventh different leader today, giving us our 11th different lead change. What about pit strategy, Ned?
Well, they're coming around to complete their 43rd lap. And in the past several years, they could run about 50 to 55 laps on a tank of fuel. I don't believe that they can run that long now with the bigger restrictor plate and also with those things up on the roof and the taller spoilers. That's going to pull a little bit more fuel through the car. So I'm thinking that they're going to maybe 50 at the outside.
And Benny, back in the spring, they ran Dale Jarrett out of gas. He was a contender and ran out of fuel, ended up losing a lap, and that cost him a very, very good possible top 10 finish.
Well, you have to be sure that you don't run out of fuel, because if you do it at the start-finish line, the time you coast around, you're going to lose a tremendous amount of distance. We talked about Jeff Burton back in 40th position. He's 4 seconds behind the leader, just 4 seconds behind the leader, and he's in touch with the pack. But if you lose 4 seconds, if you lose 1 second during a pit stop, that's about 300 yards on the racetrack. You may never get caught back up.
And outside lane, the M&M's Pontiac and Kenny Schrader, who got his very first win at this racetrack back in July of 1988. Schrader having a good run in the car number 36. And behind him is Kenny Wallace, still looking for his first Winston Cup win. Very strong car out of the Andy Petrie stable.
The bad car.
All right, we're listing the crew chiefs. They're talking to drivers. We're talking about pit strategy. We'll come back in just a moment and cover the first round of pit stops at Talladega in a moment. That was Tony Furr, right? Okay. That sounded like Tony Furr talking to Nadeau.
But then again, Okay. I got you.
Was that off the pace? Is that Junior? No, was that 60 car? It was slow on the back. Turn two. Craven maybe. 50.
Talladega Super Speedway, 45-year-old Bill Elliott leading the way. And pit stops are beginning. Here comes Rusty Wallace down pit road toward Robin Pemberton and company.
Well, Rusty Wallace makes the long trip down pit road. The engine is running, so they're not out of fuel, but you would have to believe that perhaps the light flashed. And Rusty on pit road basically all by himself. The 50 came with him. It's a four-tire stop. Clean the windshield. Around to the left side. Fuel still going in. The field still on the backstretch. Watching for Craven to come down pit road. His car still on pit road. Rusty will go off by himself. He will be all by himself. Very lonely on this 2.66-mile track.
The other drivers are coming into the pits this time around. As Ricky Craven goes out, others are coming in. Rusty got out in front of the lead pack, but they'll catch him on the backstretch. Takes a long time to get these cars up to speed.
Here's Jeff Gordon down pit road. There's the car number four, Bobby Hamilton there. Kenny Wallace is there. There's the tied car of Scott Pruitt. Johnny Benson is on pit road. Ted Musgrave in the Bell South car, the 01. Let's go down to Gordon's pit and watch this action here as those guys got to try to get four tires on. Bill Evans.
It is a four-tire stop. Gordon had to tiptoe into his pit stall. The car is just a little bit loose. Make a panel hard adjustment. Send him around to the left side. Put on two more tires on the left side. Then send Gordon back out. Car was just a little bit hot. Did not remove any tape that I saw. He headed out back to the race.
And a lot more drivers coming at you, Bill. A lot of the front runners are heading down pit road this time. About half of the field.
As they come down for lap 49, Bill Elliott will lead them down as most of the leaders now are on pit road. Kevin Graham and Dan Ford ready to service. Awesome Bill Elliott. Let's go down to Ray Dunlap.
88 and 28 are in here, Jerry. As the 88 said, we don't need any chassis adjustment at all, but guys, make sure that grill gets clean and pull 1 inch of tape off. Now to John Kernan.
Point leader Bobby Labonte is in a four-tire change. They are not making any chassis adjustments. Bill Weber. It's four tires for Earnhardt. Left's going on. You see triple pits. Earnhardt's on his way. Dale Jr. behind him. The 43 was all here. And the racetrack pit road is underway.
And Bill Elliott is the first one of this group to exit pit road, although he did not have the quickest stop. Because of where he was pitting at the far end, he was able to beat. And now Earnhardt is being shipped in front of Elliott. And as they come up on the racing surface, remember, these were green flag pit stops.
And they were told in the driver's meeting, Jerry, to keep those left wheels down on that yellow line until you get over to turn two.
Let's go to John Kernan.
Matt Kenseth, one of the Rouseketeers, who is hanging back toward the back of the pack, is in for his pit stop, a four-tire change. They also made a chassis adjustment on the left rear to Bill Weber.
And as we talked about this part of the plan, they wanted to make sure pit road was clear. They were able to stay out another lap. Apparently a fuel mileage attempt here by the Roush guys. It's four tires for Burton working on the left side. They cleaned the grill. He's got fuel, and now he will be held. Jeff Burton is being held by the official. This would have to be, I would imagine, too fast down pit road. Being held for 15 seconds. This will be very costly. Burton is on his way. We'll check.
All four Roush cars, or four Roush cars, I should say, pitting on that lap, the 17, the 99, the 97, the 21 of Elliott Sadler has a Roush engine.
Well, that will be devastating to Jeff Burton. Here comes Mark Martin into the pits. He stayed out and led a lap. Bill?
Now Mark Martin on pit road, and he's a very lonely figure. A track bar adjustment on the rear. Now they come around to the left side. Again, four tires for all these cars. Fuel going in. Mark, no complaints about the car. Working on the left-hand side. Fuel going in. Now having some trouble with the left front. They could not seat the left front tire on. Finally got it on the studs. Tighten the lug nuts. Mark's on his way.
Also, Michael Waldrop exiting pit road and Stacy Compton. Those three cars putting on that 50-yard. You're keeping a pit chart at home. And we have been, and I perish to say this, we have been caution-free thus far for the first 51 laps as they flash by that time. Green flag pit stops have been in order of the day. The first round of pit stops between laps 47 and 51.
That's pretty good strategy on those, some of those guys to stop. And the 7 car all of a sudden was leading the race as you run out of fuel, Ned.
Well, I wonder, but did he just come out of the pits?
He just came out of the pits just a moment ago. He was in on pit road with the 6 car and the 9 car, and it looks like he's trying to get up to speed.
I think that's what the situation was. It does take a long time to get these cars up to speed. He had taken the lead as a result of staying out on the track while others did it.
He should be up to speed by now, so something is amiss with Michael Walker's car.
Yeah, he is not back to running nearly like he was before. And we are being told they have crew members in the Citgo Supercar team for Jeff Burton over the wall too soon. That was the reason for the 15-second hold by NASCAR a moment ago for Jeff Burton on pit road.
He is now 18 and a half seconds behind the leader, who is Bill Elliott. He does have a drafting partner now in the way of the 50 car of Ricky Craven.
There you see the cars that pitted just a moment ago. Michael Waltrip. And Mark Martin, as you watch, Boone Whitaker, the rear tire changer on Joe Nemechek's car.
Why would he just put two tires on in there? Had to stand there long enough to put two more on, wait for it to get full of gas.
That doesn't make sense.
Did you ever find out who's carrying the tires for Boo Whitaker?
Whoa, oh, I thought that was scared me too when I saw it. He drove it up there. Mm-hmm. I thought he was sliding up there. Oh, that's Earnhardt. No wonder.
Ooh-hoo.
Well, that's Park trying to catch his boss. Might have hung himself out to dry. No, he's there with Earnhardt. Maybe.
And Burton's fallen almost 20 seconds behind now, so he doesn't.
Summarizing pit stops.
Neil, did you ever find who's the tire carrier for Boo Whitaker? Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Talladega Super Speedway in Talladega, Alabama. I'm Jerry Punch, along with Ned Jarrett, Benny Parsons, John Kernan, Ray Dunlap, and Bill Weber, bringing you exciting live action of the 32nd running of the Winston 500 presented by UPS.
There are 37 cars in the lead draft. The 37th place car of Stacy Compton is 3 seconds behind the leader, Bill Elliott. But Jeff Burton. Here he is with Rick Mask in the green number 14, Burton in the middle, and Ricky Craven in the red number 50. They are more than 20 seconds behind the leader and losing ground every lap. In fact, they were only 21 seconds this last time back.
Take a look at our cold pit summary. If you just joined us, we've had green flag pit stops between laps 47 and 51. Elliott, great pit work in first, out first. Earnhardt lost 7 spots. Earnhardt Jr., that is. Earnhardt Sr. lost 10 spots. Kenseth gained quite a bit. And Ricky Rudd, basically a wash. He lost 1 spot coming out.
Dale Earnhardt, the 3 car, is up on the outside, but he's trying to get down to the inside, trying to, he says, come on, dear son, let me in the bottom lane, will you let me in? He says, no, let's go down the door, whatever.
Well, we saw Rusty Wallace come down pit road basically by himself, although the 50 was there. They had to come down on that lap, which was 49, because they weren't sure, 100% sure, they could get to lap 50. They didn't want to run out. They had to come early that time to find out. John?
Keep an eye on Ward Burton. He's running. He was running in the fourth spot last time he came by the pit road area, but his water temperature is reading at 280 degrees. So his crew chief Tommy Baldwin said, every now and then, kind of get out of the draft a little bit to get some air into the radiator to cool things off. And Tommy also said, Bud, don't worry about it because everybody's running a little bit hot here. And also Michael Waltrip, when he left pit road, a little bit of problem getting up to speed, as we could see and we documented. Talked to his crew chief, Bobby Kennedy. He said, I don't know if there's a problem. Michael didn't tell me there was a problem, but he did come up to speed pretty slowly, but everything looks like it's okay now. To Ray Dunlap.
Well, John, Johnny Benson came in, had a real good pit stop from Jay Minson's crew. This car he's driving today, the first time out in the year 2000, when Johnny went to get off of pit road, he said, I just lost second gear. That doesn't matter when they're racing right now, but next time he comes down for a pit stop, could be a big problem for Benson, who now does not have second gear.
I'm surprised that Michael Waltrip, now his car is up to speed. It looks like that he had lost a cylinder, something had happened, but now back up speed, and Earnhardt is trying everything he knows to get back up to the front. He's working his way. He's right beside Joe Nemechek. He was tempted to step the last year in the fifth or sixth position.
And Bill Elliott is showing the way. Awesome Bill from Dawsonville, Georgia. This is the car Bill Elliott debuted at Daytona in July in the Pepsi 400. They nicknamed it Mac Mama. He led twice for 42 laps at Daytona in July, got tapped from behind by another car. Spawn hit the wall, finished 38th. They rebuilt this car and felt like this would be one of the cars to beat today. And indeed, he's showing here early on. Look at that, 14 lead changes among 9 different drivers.
As Earnhardt in the 3 and the 33 of Nemechek get side by side, it allows those cars in front of them that's lined up in a line to pull away from him by just a little bit. But that's not a big problem. As soon as Earnhardt and Nemechek settles this dispute for fifth, they'll get behind and push back that quickly.
I think that's what that front four there are hoping, that they'll continue to race side by side back there, just since they can't pull away. But you're right. I think even if they lose half a straightaway, I think they'll still be able to catch back up.
Jimmy Joe Nemechek's done a pretty good job of working his way back up after being shuffled early on. Good pit work in the pits for the crew down there, the Oakwood Homes crew. And now he's trying to battle his way back side by side with Earnhardt. A little bit of a push from behind by Ricky Rudd.
Scott Pruitt's also doing a good job in the 32 car. He started back quite a ways. Started back 35th, but now he's been shown 12th the last time by.
Different colors on that Tide car this week.
That's got the Crimson Tide colors. We're in Alabama, so they got Roll Tide on that car. For those of you who are football fans, you saw Alabama roll on ESPN in our coverage on Saturday night primetime when they had a huge win over Ole Miss. And now that's what Scott Pruitt would like to do, is gain some momentum with those colors in his car in front of this partisan Alabama crowd.
Took a look up on the outside of Dale Jarrett, but he just couldn't muster enough speed to pull up there.
He's got Dave Marcus behind trying to help him get to the front. And I talked about everyone was concerned about the Chevrolets driving away, but right now he has Ford in first and third and a Pontiac in second. And Earnhardt, the first Chevrolet, battling for fifth with another Pontiac. So right now, the makes are pretty well balanced.
And still cannot. I am so excited for Dave Marcus and all those wonderful Dave Marcus fans who have got to be enjoying his run here today. Marcus hanging on back in seventh position. If you look down from high above Talladega at that 4,000-foot back straightaway. Let's check in down in the Jeff Burton pits with Bill Weber.
Well, as you guys in the booth pointed out, the 99 car was penalized for one man going over the wall too soon. Watch this video. There are two Sitco cars on the track. One is Elliott Sadler, one is Jeff Burton. What happens here as they come down pit road, you see even our camera guy almost followed the wrong Sitco car. The Jackman looked at the 21 instead of the 99 and started to go over the wall, only put one foot over, but then that's what resulted in the penalty. The two cars looking very similar coming down pit road.
Wow, I hadn't thought about that. But and you know what? They're both blue and white in this particular race. Elliott Sadler has a different paint job, and they look almost identical.
And they're pitting three pits apart, so that was an honest mistake. Wasn't meant to gain an advantage at all for Jeff Burton, but what it did was hurt him quite a bit on the racetrack.
Yeah, he is now 24 seconds behind the leader and losing ground every lap. He's in a three-car draft and simply not running fast as this front group is running.
Elliott, Andretti, and Dale Jarrett. Ford, Pontiac, and Ford. The first Chevrolet is now five car lengths back. That is Earnhardt alongside the Pontiac. Big Caterpillar colors for Ward Burton. Well, he's a two-time winner here at Talladega. Remember that dominating performance back in 1985 when Awesome Bill made up two laps to win the Winston 500? He leads it after 64 laps. We'll be right back.
That was very good. Very, very good. Who told you that, Bill? The cameraman? Or one of the crew?
Oh, look at that. Tony Stewart almost on the apron there.
Okay. Camera move scared me there, Mike.
Yeah. Wow. Welcome back to our live coverage of NASCAR Winston Cup competition from Talladega Super Speedway. If you just joined us, Joe Nemechek, Front Row Joe, became the 13th different pole sitter in the year 2000 and the latest entry in the 2001 Bud Shootout Qualifier. Our Bud Pole Award goes to Joe Nemechek for this 32nd running of the Winston 500. But on the very first lap, as Joe let him down, he told us before the race, I'm going to be a sitting duck, and boy, was he Karnak or what? Take a look, they went by on both sides.
Went down in turn one, Earnhardt Jr. started third, dove to the inside. They got Nemechek in the middle, and he has been just dusted on both sides. But now he went back as far as 15th or 20th, but now he's back up to the sixth position, racing alongside Dale Earnhardt. And they've been running side by side for, seems like forever, probably the last five laps, and the top four cars even lined up, not able to drive away from them.
Joe Nemechek's Long Winston Cup victory came in September a year ago up at Loudon, New Hampshire. Looking for his second career victory, but first ever at Talladega, as he's holding on to the inside groove there right in front of Ricky Rudd, Earnhardt, and Dave Marcus. quickness on the high side there. Those cars are fifth, sixth, seventh, and eighth.
And it is interesting, Jerry, you mentioned a moment ago that they've been running side by side there for a long time, but still keeping pace with that four cars that are running single file out in front of them.
Right now we have 37 cars in this lead draft.
News from above, courtesy of the fine folks at Pennzoil, our Pennzoil copter cam, showing you them spreading out three wide and intermittently four wide here at Talladega Super Speedway.
Look at the car in the middle, maybe Jeremy Mayfield is off the pace. Something has happened to the Mobile 1 Ford. I believe it's Jeremy.
They had their troubles in practice. They only got a couple laps of practice prior to Bud Cole qualifying. They had an engine problem, and now he just waved people by. Jeremy Mayfield had six consecutive DNFs until that second place finish last Sunday at Lowe's Motor Speedway. So six of the last seven events, they've had horrendous luck, and looks like it may be biting him again as Jeremy gets slower and slower on the racetrack.
Well, he pushed the car up in neutral and turned the engine off, which is a very, very bad sign. It's like almost obvious that he has an engine problem with the car. John Kernan.
Jeremy Mayfield is headed to the garage area. He radioed his crew chief, Peter Suspenzo, and said there's something wrong. Could be the engine, could be the rear end. They asked him to check the ignition box. He said to switch to the secondary ignition. He said, I've already done that. That's not the problem. So he is headed back to the garage area. They're going to put up on jack stands and see exactly what the problem is.
Well, tough break for Jeremy Mayfield. He had come from 40th starting spot all the way to the top 10 and now heads to the garage area. Well, how close is the field? We told you they were only just a few seconds apart. We're going to hold this shot and watch the leader come by and go from first to 36th position. Just that fast. That's how, folks, you take a couple of hiccups and a deep breath and 36 is already gone by.
That was 3.1 seconds.
Many of the drivers predicted this week with the rule change that if you started this race at Talladega, you had a chance to lead it. And thus far, it looks like they're holding true.
Well, that's true. A lot of guys have been up here, and a lot of guys have led the race. And it looks like that the old master, Earnhardt, just will not give up. He just refuses to go backwards. He goes down and tries to slow the 22 car down to try to get some push from the 71 car. Meanwhile, here comes a group of cars on the outside of it. They're going to get a run on Earnhardt.
Points leader, the Interstate Batteries Pontiac, riding back in the back of the pack in 29th position. Hasn't led a lap today, but remember, he had his most comfortable point margin of the season, 252 points coming in with just five events remaining, four after today.
Jerry, I think he's riding. I think he's being very patient and he's riding. You know, the leaders aren't going away anywhere, so he's just staying in position.
Well, the front three cars, Ford, Pontiac, and Ford, Elliott, Andretti, and Dale Jarrett. As the fans flash their colors and the crew members watch and wait. After 72 laps, Awesome Bill showing the way.
Hey, Ward Burton's got a fast race car. He's able to, you know, he backs off to let it cool a little bit, and he loses the draft of the front three and gets back and runs a couple laps side by side with Earnhardt. All of a sudden, he pulls out and catches that group in front of him, and the rest of them can't come with him.
Wow. Okay.
Car breakaway. You got 10 car lanes open behind you.
They're only running 51-50, 51-60 up front.
What did they run a while ago?
I wasn't on them then.
I see the speed's 90. I thought it was 190 before.
A little faster that time, 15:51.22. Check's been able to break loose from the side by side.
Our ESPN coverage of exciting NASCAR action from Talladega, Alabama is being brought to you by Budweiser. With a crisp, clean, refreshing taste you'll find in no other beer, this Bud's for you. By Team Monte Carlo, the cars more champions trust. And by Daytona USA, the official attraction of NASCAR. Just a reminder, coming up later today, 5 o'clock Eastern time, over on ESPN2, you can see our coverage of the Automobile Racing Club of America Windexy 300 from right here at Talladega Super Speedway. 300 miles of racing action, ARCA style, from the world's fastest stock car facility. For more, log on to ESPN.com.
Meanwhile, nothing has changed since we left you. Bill Elliott still leads. John Andretti is in second. Dale Jarrett is third. Ward Burton is still fourth. And Dale Earnhardt is now easing back because Dave Marcus has taken over that fifth spot. And Sterling Marlin appears to be off the pace. Bill, wonder what's going on.
Benny, at first they thought it was an alternator problem. Now it's starting to miss. When he went by, the crew listened, says like it's down a complete cylinder. So Sterling Marlin on the track, but off the pace. We go to John.
In the garage area with Jeremy Mayfield, whose crew is working on the car. Jeremy, what happened?
I'm not sure. We're trying to find out if we drove something. This Mobile 1 Ford has been done a good job. You know, we started in the back, worked our way up, just going as planned. You know, resting inside, we're going to try to make laps here, get to the end, and made it seem like we had a lot of bad luck, you know, but, you know, everybody did a good job. Just that's all you can ask for.
I heard you tell your crew on the radio that it was getting pretty hot in the car. How hot was it?
Yeah, my feet were burning pretty bad. It was like the exhaust temps were way up or something. So we'll have to look at it and see what happened. But still, you know, we had a good run going in.
All right, Jeremy Mayfield's crew working on his car back upstairs.
Wow. Seventh DNF in the last eight races. Tough break for Jeremy Mayfield on that Mobile 1 team.
Mike Skinner trying to follow Kenny Schrader. Well, but you see the maybe jumped out on the outside. And I guess they're about four wide about now. Yep, sure enough.
Bill Elliott is the leader. Elliott has led 34 laps. There is Dave Marcus and Dale Earnhardt, a couple of veterans. They nearly rubbed. Marcus with a Richard Childress engine dead and tried it and running awfully well. How about that bottom line?
Yeah, Ricky Rudd has a run coming down there with Mike Skinner right on his bumper. He's going to blow right past him. And Dale Earnhardt Jr. ran it behind Dave Marcus and had to back off and almost hit him.
Almost did. As a matter of fact, Dave Marcus, when he came off turn two, his car got a little bit loose. He had to chase it up the hill. And just that chasing, that turning right and chase up the hill, allowed those cars to drive under him and pass him off turn two.
Well, there's about 16 cars, three wide, after 78 laps at Talladega. And some of these poor folks in the grandstands have yet to sit down.
All that three abreast racing back there has allowed that single car draft up front to pull away just a little bit, but that'll come in once somebody breaks loose from here.
Well, that front bunch decided they want to race a little bit right now. They're tired of riding in the line. Bobby Hamilton has worked his way back up front with Kodak Film Chevrolet.
Well, the Steve's racing down on the inside. Steve's had a great run here today. Didn't get to qualify the car. Kyle Petty qualified it, but because he's running the truck race out in Texas, but it car. He's had it near the front all day. And right now, it's only 22nd place.
And for you Jeff Burton fans, the 99 car, the Citgo SuperGuard machine, is a half a lap behind. If you just joined us, they were held 15 seconds on pit road for a crew member coming over the wall too soon. And as Bill Weber showed us, with both the Citgo cars pitting within a couple of pits apart, the crew member got confused and came over the wall with 1 foot, and that produced the penalty. And thus, Jeff Burton, a half a lap back.
You talk about a lone man. Tony Stewart is on the outside with no one. He finally, when he sees the four car go by, falls in behind him. And Elliott Sather was back there as well. Elliott, coming down the backstretch, seemed to be by himself, but evidently he was getting grabbed from the 20 car of Tony Stewart, and he was closed up, must have passed 10 cars. Talking about that Citgo, number 21, the blue and white car. We only picked up 5 spots. Last time I was 17th, this time by Elliott Sather was 12. And the 40 car, I'm told, has been black flagged because they feel like he's not running up to the minimum speed they have.
NASCAR has a rule that you have to be within a certain percentage of the pole speed, and that currently Jeremy Marlin is not close to that, so they will bring him back to the garage area.
Then we saw Junior push his father around. Let's see if Dad can return the favor and push Junior around. Those cars dance around and move around. Those drivers would swear to you they never move. They play right between those white lines. But we know better, don't we, Ned?
Yeah, we can see it. Now, Earnhardt Sr. is going to look up on the outside of his son. Pitching in the middle because here comes Kenny Wallace up on the outside of Earnhardt.
There's the 40 car, Sterling Marlin, on pit road. The Coors Chevrolet with the hood up. The NASCAR has brought back the pit road with the black flag. And of course, NASCAR has spotters all around this racetrack to look at the racetrack. They would not take any chances if they saw anything at all. And thus far, we stay green with Bill Elliott leading here on lap number 82.
It's Ken Schrader trying to make a move up on the outside, trying to go around Dale Jarry, take over third. Outside groove, maybe beginning to work a little bit. There's a lot of them been up there trying it for a long time.
And Bobby Hamilton, that four car, was just pushing Schrader, trying to get him by those cars.
Kenny Schrader's very first Winston Cup victory came here in July of 1998. July 31st, 1998.
1988.
I'm sorry, 1988. Read my own writing. 1988. Thank you, Penny Fuck. I shouldn't write like a doctor, I guess.
Can't read what you said, huh?
I knew it wasn't 98, Jerry, because he had won one since 91.
Exactly.
And he would like to change that very much here today.
His last victory coming in June of 91. It's over 298 races ago. We're talking about Kenny Schrader, driving the Independence Pontiac.
He's making a serious challenge right now for second position. Has gotten from the outside of the four car, and is that Jeff Gordon back in the middle again coming to the front? He has gone from the front to the back, to the back to the front more than anybody I've seen today.
He's passed a lot of race cars, hasn't he?
I talked to Robbie Loomis this morning down the garage here, and he said, you know, I'm glad we've got this car, because that other car seems to run better, but I think that car has a bad attitude. At Daytona, we had all kind of trouble with the car. We brought it here. We had all kind of trouble with the car. I'm glad to get rid of that car, and it's bad attitude.
Well, on Friday morning, if you just joined us in practice, Gordon ran over a bunch of orange cones at the start-finish line with that primary car. Then at happy hour, they broke the shock absorber and watched Bobby Hamilton go to the high side. Here's a Kodak Chevrolet.
He led that lap, but unfortunately has no one with him, and he will keep falling back.
He went out there and hit that wall of air and just killed him.
Now there's Tony Stewart now trying to help that car number four of Hamilton, but he's already been backslid to about seventh or eighth position.
Can you imagine that? Bobby Hamilton led the last lap, and right now he's trying his best to stay 10th place as Steve Grissom in that Hot Wheels car drives up on the inside of him.
And this partisan Alabama crowd pulling for Steve Grissom. an Alabama native. He turned down a chance to play collegiate football because he wanted to go drive a race car.
And look at Gordon coming up on the outside.
And you can hear the fans in the background standing and waiting and screaming as they are three wide, three by three by three, for 36 positions.
And Schrader still hasn't led a lap. Jeff Gordon led the last lap, but Schrader's looking good right now. Talking about the yellow car in the middle, the M&M's car.
He's going to sit there in the middle and say, well, just got me up here. Let's see if I can stay in that position.
Schrader trying to hang on the bottom of the racetrack.
But here comes Jeff Gordon on the outside with drafting help from Jerry Nadeau. He's trying to go down and pick up Nadeau. Nadeau sees Jeff come off the corner, move on to try to pick up the 25 car.
Gordon right out front. Their pace has slowed down about a half a second a lap since they started racing. Bill Elliott was running anywhere from 51.30 to 51 in seconds, 51.60. That last lap by Jeff Gordon was 52 seconds flat.
Bobby Hamilton roaring back with a little shove from the Home Depot Pontiac of Tony Stewart. Now we're riding along with Mark Martin, who led 98 laps here in the spring. But today, he started way toward the back of the pack, back in 27th position, and is now all the way up to the 7th spot. There have been 16 lead changes among 10 different drivers, and Jeff Gordon showing the way here on lap number 87.
He's looking at the big picture, and they're looking at the small picture. Yeah.
Who's up there, Steve? Right. Randy is? Okay.
Is that Rust? Rusty Wallace up to 10th place. And Matt Kenseth, you know, he in the 97 to 99 ran back there last for so long, he couldn't stand it anymore. Up 10 seconds on the last time I looked up, is 28 seconds behind.
Yeah, it's about.
Is that Elliott's out of work for That was a little.
Today, the stakes are high on this high-bank, high-speed Talladega Oval, as these five drivers hope they are the ones to walk away with $1 million. It's the fifth and final No Bull 5 bonus battle of the year. And take a look, Jeff Gordon, one of our No Bull 5 contenders, is leading here after 91 laps. Our Craftsman race recap shows you that Jeff Gordon is the leader. He has led 8 of 91 laps. There have been 19 lead changes. And thus far, although I hate to mention it, we are caution free. A race record pace, 183.975 mile per hour average. The lap leader fell out of his head to fall thus far. Earnhardt, Stewart, Gordon, and Martin. Skinner, Bobby Hamilton, Earnhardt Jr., Dave Marcus, and Michael Walter. Off the track, still being worked on, Sterling Marlin, the poor Chevrolet, trying to get him back on the racetrack. And out of the race, Jeremy Mayfield gone to the garage area with an engine problem, as did Kevin LePage.
And Jimmy Spencer just made a pit stop a moment ago, so he's going to lap down. That's a little bit earlier than we thought that he'd be coming in, but apparently he felt he needed to stop, and so he did, as Bobby Hamilton goes for the lead.
Hamilton in the Kodak Chevrolet, the Morgan McClure stable, Runt Pittman, the engine builder. They've had some success here. They've won here with Ernie Irvin as a driver. And now these cars trying to pull away somewhat from that second pack.
And that second, Rusty Wallace is part of this five-car breakaway. But leading that second pack is Matt Kenseth and Mike Bliss. Kenseth, who for the first pit stop ran back in fourth position with a 97. After that pit stop, he has marched his way right to the front, and the last time by was in sixth position.
Let's run along with Rusty here for just a moment. Rusty Wallace on the Miller Lite roof camera, onboard camera with our Jimmy Dean telemetry. Take a look at what speed we're talking about here for Rusty's car.
So watch as he goes down the corner at 188. As soon as he goes in and hits this bank, he's going to lose a couple of RPM, a couple of miles per hour, I should say. We saw him go down to 186. Oh, he had to touch the brakes a little bit as it came off the corner. All of a sudden, the cars in front of him slowed down. As you see, the four car is losing the lead. Did something happen to the four car all of a sudden?
Well, he's been shuffled up high. It doesn't have any drafting partner, looks like.
That's the way it looks. Now he gets that down to the inside. Just like him in fifth place, but the outside line's about to go by.
I'm assuming the four car had to back off the accelerator as he came off the corner. Something happened, and he lost momentum, and he lost about 5 or 6 spots because of it, as Spencer is being pushed to the, he's putting in in reverse and going to the garage. Ray, what's going on?
Well, Benny, they came in just a couple laps ago to put tires on this car, and again, we're having overheating problems down here. Jimmy said the car was getting very hot. They put tires on it, went out, ran 2 laps, and he said, I just broke the shock on the right rear, so the mount they think is broken, so he's gone behind the wall so that they can work on that. We hear a DJ, Dale Jarrett, is also talking about his car getting hot again. It's been over 240 degrees, so one more time he dropped back out of that pack and he's lost a lot of positions. They're talking about making another change on the front of this car when they pit, and we expect that in about 5 or 6 laps to see the 88 coming to pit road.
And he and John Andretti had been running second and third, and both of them dropped all the way back. I don't know if Andretti's having a similar problem or not, but he's back there in 33rd place. So,
and then just 5 laps ago, Bill Elliott was in the front as Earnhardt gets a little bit squirrely there trying to pull out to make a move. And the 20 car goes way up the racetrack, Benny.
Oh, is there something up there? I mean, the same thing happened the last time with the leader. Bobby Hamilton came off the corner and all of a sudden goes high on the racetrack, lost momentum. Same thing has happened to Tony Stewart.
There had been a report from some of the crews of some possible oil and that into the racetrack, and so now we've seen at least 3 cars get all squirreled in there. You gotta wonder. I started to say a moment ago, Bill Elliott was leading about 6 laps ago, and now he has dropped all the way back to the 33rd position.
They're about to come up on Darrell Waltrip and put a lap on him.
As Earnhardt is going for the lead. Dale Earnhardt, Goodrich Chevrolet. He's there. He has it.
That could be lead change number 24 here at Talladega. What about Bobby Hamilton, John?
Jerry, you can see he's trying to kick his way back to the front. What happened with him, his belts came loose. So he was trying to tighten them up as he was driving and kind of had to slow down just a little bit longer.
lost a little momentum. Now he's trying to work his way toward the front. One interesting note about Hamilton and the crew, the first pit stop, they took on only right side tires. The car has gotten tight in the course of this run. So Bobby said, hey guys, we have to take on four tires this next stop.
I tell you, if my belts came loose at 200 miles an hour, if you need more than just a pit stop, you need air pressure.
I would stop and think I would tighten them back up. And wow. Well, we're coming up on halfway, and we've had 24 lead changes. As I told you at the very top of the show, they've averaged since 1969 over 45 lead changes per race, and looks like we're going to beat that number again today. We have a, certainly have a good possibility of doing that.
And for those of you who are recording pit stops and thinking about when they may come back in, remember, Rusty Wallace was the very first car to pit at 37. And we are now showing 98 laps complete. Pit stops took place under the green flag from lap 47 and 51. So any time now, the next handful of laps, they should be peeling off for green flag pit stops. Take a look at where the No-Ball 5 contenders are running. Earnhardt, one of those million-dollar hopefuls, leading. Jeff Gordon back in 6th, Martin 12th, Steve Park 27th, and Jeff Burton back in 36th position.
Jeff Burton. And he's running with continues to lose ground to the leaders. They're just now across the start-finish line, 43.8 seconds behind the leaders. And he's suggesting going to lap down.
And then the pit stops will begin here in earnest on lap number 99. Jeff Gordon, Dale Jarrett, Ricky Rudd, Dave Blaney, Bill Elliott. Let's go down the race.
Robert Yates racing cars come in together. Dale Jarrett gives him plenty of room on the wall, but Ricky Rudd was over the line just a little bit, and he's going to be awfully close to the inside wall. A little bit of a chassis change for Dale Jarrett as they're cleaning windshields on both sides. They go half a pound down on the right front for Dale Jarrett, and no chassis change here for Ricky Rudd. Now to Bill Weber.
No changes for Jeff Gordon. Four tires and fuel, good stop. He's on his way. Jarrett rolls out behind him, followed by the 10.
On Jeff Gordon's pit crew, pit stop, great stop, and Bill Elliott's crew also have a, they have a great stop. And here, all the cars coming down pit road.
Earnhardt, they do. There's Bobby Hamilton. Earnhardt Jr., 55 miles an hour. Headed to you, John Gernon.
Bobby Hamilton Jr. coming down into his pit as he gets counted in. It'll be a four tire change, no adjustments. In fact, that's what we should see from just about everybody. Tony Stewart pulls in his stall just behind him. Bobby Labonte also in. Work done on the right side for the Morgan McClure team. Robert Markins, the jack man, swings around. One pump, gets it up. The tires already coming off, going on to Bill Weber.
For Earnhardt, it is four tires, fuel, extra man over the wall to clean the windshield. Working on the left rear, now he's down in the way.
And Rusty Wallace pulled out a narrowly clipped Earnhardt. He's trying to leave pit road there.
Very close. I thought he was going to get him. I was looking at it as opposed to the monitor when they were coming out, and I thought he was going to hit him.
Scott Pruitt in the tied four cars, getting his service and getting back on the racetrack. Well, we've got two pit stops. Both under the green, and here is Ward Burton on pit road. John Kearney?
Ward Burton is in for what we would assume would be a four-tire change. Remember, the car was running so hot earlier, about 280 degrees. They still haven't taken any tape off of the front grill, but when Ward was able to get out, now they do take a piece of tape off the front grill to get a little more air in there. He said it had cooled down just a little bit. A four-tire change for Ward Burton, also for Matt Kenseth and Michael Waltrip.
Just a moment ago, we saw the four car Bobby Hamilton have trouble. Oh, we're going. See, Boo Whitaker changed that rear tire on Joe Nemechek's car. They throw that other tire on there. It goes around to the left side. All right, left nuts are coming off. They pitch in the other tire, pitch the gun up. Five left nuts are tightened down. And Hamilton had a slow pit stop.
It'll be a four-tire change.
He had trouble on the left front. We see Ed McClure going over to clean the windshield. NASCAR has allowed an extra man across the wall. Robert Larkins lets the car down, brings that jack around. But when the front tire changer comes around and takes a tire off, Ed McClure is in the way. See, they got the tire in the way, and they could not get to the tire immediately, and it cost him about 2 seconds extra.
It cost him about 20 positions on the racetrack.
Wow.
The last time around, he was being shown in the 22nd position, and he was right up there in the top five when he came in.
And that team is a four-time winner at Talladega, twice with Ernie Irvin and twice with Sterling Marlin, as you watch Stacy Compton bring a mowing Ford Taurus down pit road, and he was being shown as the leader, so one of the Rookie of the Year contenders in the Revestis Rookie of the Year competition. Stacy Compton in the pits, and now Ted Musgrave showing the way in the Bell South Chevrolet. The car number 01 is our leader. After 102 laps are in the books at Talladega, we'll be right back.
But he hadn't stopped here. Jeff Burton needed to run, and yeah, they're about to. What did he do? Oh boy, what a break for Jeff Burton and Ted Musgrave.
That is a huge break. Caution number one on lap 103.
Well, they might have got lapped. They might have got passed. Looks like Gordon's got in front of him. Well, I think they just got passed. Let's see. Yeah, but they didn't get the caution last time. They're getting caution this time, aren't they? So they're going to be a lap down. Yep. Huh? I know it. Yeah. Yep. But they were right directly in front of the leader when they came by the last lap, just and had not stopped. So they were. Well, where are they? Okay. Yep,
by not having
right.
got yep, stopped, yep, they would yep, have been leading.
Right. Yep, yeah, that's right. Yep. Yep. Yep.
Thank you.
Yep. Yeah. Well, this is a huge break for them. They're just going to have to stop.
Right.
Got to caution. Dave Marcus has a problem with that. Oh, yeah, there's going to be a lap down after they made your pit stop.
Yep.
Right. Back at Talladega Super Speedway, we have just seen the caution flag for the first time today. Dave Marcus, 59 years of age, who qualified ninth and actually led in the early part, rolled his car, coasted down out of turn four, has been pushed now back to the garage area, apparently with an engine problem, and he will have to call it a day. They take the window net down, and now Dave will climb out.
And Jerry, this is a huge break for Ted Musgrave in 01. Jeff Burton in 99 and Rick Mast in 14. They had not made a pit stop. They were almost a lap down before the leaders made their green flag pit stops, but this caution has saved them. They're going to be on the lead lap. Yeah, they'll be back at the tail end of the lead lap, but they would have been lapped if they would have pitted under green. Let's go to the pits and John.
Ward Burton, who had just pitted under the green, decides to come in and pit again. The crew says Ward just wanted four new tires, so that's what they're going to do. They're also going to pull the fender off the left front because it was rubbing the left front tire to Bill Weber.
Unbelievable break for Jeff Burton. Unbelievable. It's four tires, a little bit of tape off the grill. Cool, he's on his way. Now he stalls and he had to get going. Ted Musgrave was pitted right in front of him. Musgrave had run out of fuel and requested to be pushed down pit road by Burton. He helped him out, then he was able to go around him. Ward is still on pit road. The 43 is also on pit road, getting left side tires. So a number of cars taking advantage of this caution to John.
And Ward Burton's crew, you see Tommy Baldwin Jr. pulling out on the fender on the left front. What they, it looks like there might have been just a little bit of contact to push it in, and there was a tire rub on that left front tire because you can see just how shiny it was around it. Back up to the booth as they sent Ward out.
Well, Tommy Baldwin pulls that fender away as Ward Burton puts that Husqvarna Caterpillar Pontiac back in gear and will exit pit road. Back in just a moment.
Okay. Okay.
Is that 31 or 3 in third?
31.
I mean 31 or 11, I should say.
Look at 31.
Why are some of those numbers green and some?
It's in cars, isn't it?
Huh? I got you. Need to put in a color, it's a little easier to read. How did Marcus get in? They push him in?
Did they just stopped Marcus? At there at the entrance pit road.
And the wrecker pushed him in?
At Talladega Super Speedway, a reminder to join us tonight at 9 p.m. Eastern Time for RPM Tonight. Reed Davis will have a wrap-up of our Winston Cup action from Talladega, the Indy Racing Northern Lights Series, Texas Highlights, and the CART FedEx Championship Series from Down Under in Australia. That's 9 Eastern, 6 Pacific, RPM Tonight. For more, log on to ESPN.com. As we show you our top 15 in our Napa Field Summary after pit stops, working the first caution flag today, coming out on lap 103. We'll come back with a green flag in just a moment.
Shot coming back with all of them going nuts. Yeah. Oh, that's cold. Funny, but cold.
They love him.
Well, they love T-Bone like we do.
Matt Kenseth and Elliott Sadler coming off pit road. I wonder what that means.
Probably topping off a few while they were back near the back. Anyway, that'd be my guess.
That's a cola.
Back at Talladega, what a great crowd. Sherry, press record. So Sherry, you get the message, press record. He wants to keep this, but this is a great one to watch when he gets home, although he's watching it here live. And take a look at this crowd. Some 170,000 NASCAR fans have stood for much of this one and waved their hats and screamed and applauded. Folks, that's what it's all about. Look at that sea of people here at Talladega Super Speedway. Let's get out of John Kerner.
Well,
One update on Ward Burton. I said he had some contact with that left front. He actually, when pulling into his pit during the green flag pit stop, he actually made contact with his rear tire carrier, Mike Brown, and just kind of pushed in that left front fender. But Mike is all right. No harm, no foul, just a little incidental contact.
As the Pontiac safety car makes a hard left-hand turn, Jeff Gordon, who won it here in the spring from 36th starting spot. Folks, if you just joined us, he had to go to the back of the pack and started 40th today. He's our leader. We get set for the restart. Flag at the very beginning of this race, and Joe Nemechek went back in a hurry in that one, but thus far, guys, looks like Gordon's hanging on.
I think the difference is the single file restart as opposed to the double file restart at the start of the race.
I agree with you, Ned. It is the single file restart. We saw a couple of cars, Dave Burney and Ricky Clayton, on the inside. Those two cars are lapped down to our leader, Jeff Gordon.
Well, Jeff Gordon has been a part of six different no ball five bonus days. He has won three of them, so he's batting 500. This is his seventh time to get a chance to win a no ball five. But the guy right behind him, Dale Earnhardt, who's trying to go for the lead, has also had six chances. He has never won one. That could change today.
Well, Earnhardt has a Jeff Gordon, Jerry Mayhew helping him, and Jeff Gordon has Mike Skinner, Dale Earnhardt's teammate helping him. It looks like Nadeau is doing a better job than Skinner right now.
Yeah, we have seen that the low groove in the early going after they put new tires on the cars has been the best groove. And it looks like it's that way again.
Shuffle. Let's check in the Jeff Burton pitch with Frankie Stoddard. There's Bill Weber standing by.
Well, I'm here with Frank Stoddard. You got a break. You dodged a bullet, didn't you?
Well, we certainly did. I hope we can dodge some more bullets after. The Citgo Super Guy guys were pretty good today. We just came back there riding, and we got a penalty that, you know, was a penalty that was probably right. I mean, the guy, his foot was over the wall, but you got to work with somebody a little bit. He didn't go anywhere. We jumped in the wrong car. The other Citgo car was going down the thing. He didn't go over. It didn't make the pit stop any faster. He stayed there until actually our car was in the pit, if you watch the film, which made it even worse for us. I wish that we had a little bit of a working relationship there, but I'm disappointed with that. But we got it back, so I won't argue as much.
Okay, we'll see if the 99 car can work his way all the way back to the front now.
Frank Stoddard, the crew chief for Jeff Burton. And he just joined us. The caution came out on lap 103, and Burton, Ted Musgrave, and Rick Mast had not pitted, so they were able to pit under the caution. And others come back in, and that kept them from possibly losing a lap, or surely losing a lap, so that's why they are still on the lead lap. And, Ned, we've got, 35 cars still on the lead lap.
35 cars on the lead lap, and they're running within about 4 seconds of each other, or actually 2.8 seconds of each other.
And some of our spotters have told us that still that left front tire on the 22 car might be rubbing a little bit still. And look at Skinner down underneath the yellow line, trying to get by Dale Earnhardt Jr. He does that with some drafting help from Bobby Labonte, our points leader. So Labonte all of a sudden now up in the fifth position.
Dale Jarrett had gone out to try to pass on the outside, and the whole line went by on the inside. So that, what looked like was going to be a good move, turned out to be a bad move. Here's Mark Martin up there by himself. He's running pretty good up there, making three wide.
And there is awesome Bill Elliott trying to work his way back. Elliott is back there, so is John Andretti. And Cheerios Pontiac for the King, Richard Petty.
They've been 1-2 for so long back 30, 40 laps ago. And all of a sudden, Elliott's car is just not right. I don't know exactly what happened, but all of a sudden, anyway, Mike Skinner is hooked up with Dale Earnhardt Jr., and they are trying their best to take the lead.
And Earnhardt Sr. and Rusty Wallace trying to hang on as you're taking a look riding along right there with our Circuit City onboard for points leader Bobby Labonte, who sits back there in about fifth position.
Hey, Bobby, we said earlier that he was riding, which was smart to do for a long time, to sit there and ride, get laps behind you. But now we're past the halfway point. Time to go. How about it, John?
Well, Ned, I would guess you're absolutely right. During that last caution, Bobby was talking to Jim Makar and the crew, and he said, guys, he says, I'm kind of sorry. He said, I'm just not having a very good game of chess right now. He said, I'm having problems picking out the wrong lines. And obviously now, he's gotten his concentration going. I guess he's got his game on, you might say, and he's picking the right line, it looks like to me, because he looks like he's headed toward the front.
We mentioned a lot of these engine builders have flown back to their shops last night. Among those is Mark Cronquist, who built engines for Bobby Labonte and Tony Stewart, both the Joe Gibbs cars. They flew back, worked much of the night, trying to see what the carburetors were going to do on these cars today with the smaller plate that they put on yesterday prior to happy hour. And obviously that work is paying off for the 18 car.
On the lap 114, we'll check as they come by.
Still got a great battle going on for lead, but this time it's Dale Earnhardt Jr. trying to pass his dad. Taking the lead, but now Bobby Hamilton has worked his way back in front. He's on the outside. We've got Earnhardt Jr., Hamilton, and Jeff Gordon. Oh, somebody, that's the 22 left front tires going for Evan Ward-Burke's car. We mentioned it was still running a little bit. It rubbed too much, and the tire is flat.
And what a job he did, Ned, to hang on to that car right in the middle. He's in the middle of like three cars with about seven or eight right behind him.
Yeah, he did do a great job. And caution is out. They'll race back to the flag with it. There's no big deal here, but that could have been the big one. Bill?
Ford dropped back is because he was running with the 22. They were going to try and work their way to the front together. Elliott saw Ward was having a problem. His crew told him Ward was rubbing the tire. Elliott got out of the gas. That's why he went to the back. But he made the right decision.
Now, as you ride along with our Husqvarna onboard camera, tough break for Ward Burton, who had been at the front of the pack most of the day. Let's get Tommy Baldwin in the crew as he comes to a halt. Let's go down to John Kernan.
And they're going to change the left side tires, of course, first, but you can see a lot of aerodynamic damage to that left front where the belt come off and just wrapped itself up and hit the, knocked the hood up from the inside. So they're going to have to work on that. Also, some of what was left of the tire of the tread is wrapped around the brake rotor. So now one of the crewmen trying to pull that away to get it off. Tommy Baldwin on the radio saying, we got some time. Just do your jobs. And now Tommy will actually get in and try and pull it out as it is stuck, as the pace car is in the middle of three and four. They now turn the wheel to try and make it a little bit easier access to get the rest of the tread out of that left front wheel. And it looks like, oh man, they're coming out of four right now, so they're quickly running out of time, having a problem pulling this out. Oh, now they finally do get it out. Now he tells him to turn the wheel to the right so they can get it on. Tommy Baldwin gets the lug nuts tight. Here comes the pace car. And Ward Burton is down in a way, but he will have to come back in, change right side tires, and also try and smooth out that aerodynamic damage that was done to the hood and the fender.
And here come the leaders down pit road with this caution coming down on lap 114, lap 115. They peel off under the caution to pit. Let's go down the Ray.
Well, guys, will it be four tires or two? It'll be four all the way around for the Yates cars because they think there is a strategy here. They may only have to pit one more time, and that may give them a chance to take gas only. Some guys will take two tires this time. Bill Weber?
Dale Earnhardt on pit road. This will be two tires only. Two tires is Bill Earnhardt watching traffic and heads back out.
Pit road, and there is Bill Elliott finally getting into his pits. At the far end of pit road, you see Dale Jr. side, as you heard John Kernan say, strategy here for both the Yates cars, taking on four tires here.
And look at one car. The one car is sitting on pit road. He just simply could not get into his pit. Finally, they changed the tires, and there is no penalty for that. If he makes an effort to do that, that's all that's required of him.
If he gets his front tires.
Okay, what happens when you cut a tire at 190 miles per hour? Let's listen.
Okay.
And watch this left front tire. The tire almost immediately stops turning. That tread comes off and wraps itself around the chassis, and almost immediately, as soon as we see the left front tire, it is not rolling. It's sliding across the racetrack. I can't show you what I'm talking about. Just in a moment, you'll be able to read Goodyear on that tire. See? It's not turning.
Well, in the tough break, the poor luck for Ward Burton on lap 114 brings out the second caution flag today. He is back on pit road. Mike Bliss being shown as our leader.
The 32 car ran into 01, I believe. The 01 was coming out, and the 32 went in, and I think he knocked right there. See, the 01 is sitting there, and I guess they're just putting gas on, and here comes a 32 car. Yeah. Who was Park trying to turn around? Why was he? No. Well, that's what the 01 did. See, the 01, it just puts fuel in the car. One minute, Jerry, 1 minute.
Thank you, Ronnie. So we're going to come back and talk about, okay. Back at Talladega Super Speedway here in Talladega, Alabama. Working caution number 2 on the day. A tough break for Ward Burton. The left front tire being cut down.
And just a moment ago, during the pit stops, a very, very close call. Ted Musgrave is sitting here, fuel only in his car. The red car of Scott Pruitt, he dodges Earnhardt as he comes in. He starts with his pit, and all of a sudden has to turn left and runs into the 0-1 car of Musgrave as he leaves, and did some damage to the left front of Pruitt's car. He spent a lot of time on pit road trying to repair that damage and make sure that his fender wasn't rubbing the tire like Ward Burton's.
All right, looking back at the Viagra Pontiac for Mike Bliss, the first race he had led in his NASCAR Winston Cup career. Back with more in just a moment. Ronnie, while we're in break, I'm going to reposition my headset again here. I didn't put it back on straight, so now that it feeds back a minute, I'm just because I'm playing with it here. 1, 2, 3, 1. With my headset. Okay. Thank you, Chevy. Thanks a lot.
I thought we said Earnhardt only took two.
Earnhardt only took two.
The three took two tires.
That's what.
She didn't say that.
She didn't say that, but I thought we said that.
We said that earlier.
So when he was coming out, yeah. Okay.
The 91 and the 2 took fuel only, she said, right? 94 and 2. Mm. Right, took fuel only. Right. Okay.
He didn't pit. I don't think so. Yep. Yep.
Oh.
Don't get caught up in all that mess down there in pit road.
Are those two engaged, or are they? Oh, I see.
Oh, really? Okay.
Back at Talladega Super Speedway in Talladega, Alabama. I'm Jerry Punch along with Ned Jarrett, Benny Parsons, Bill Weber, Ray Dunlap, and John Kernan bringing you live coverage of the Winston 500.
How about that 47th driver, Mike, this is, to lead at least one lap this season. That is pretty competitive.
You just about everybody here. They've probably been 55 or 60 different drivers.
Well, we've had 15 different leaders here today, 31 lead changes so far. And that number might change as we go back to green flag racing.
And Rusty is trying his best to block the 31 car. And looks like he's been able to succeed. Skinner could not get by the two. As a matter of fact, when he backed off the throttle to avoid Ross, he lost momentum and lost his spot.
And I don't think Rusty, according to my records, has not led today, but that could change here in about a half a lap.
Well, he's going for it. He's got Dale Earnhardt Jr. there to push him on by.
This car, Rusty's driving, finished fourth in the Daytona 500, finished third at Daytona in July. And he's getting a shove from a big Budweiser hood from Earnhardt Jr.
Jimmy Spencer comes back out of the garage area at the end of the race. He's been out for a long time.
And Rusty Wallace becomes our 16th different driver to lead this one today after 120 laps are in the books.
And we see Rusty about to lose a position as Earnhardt Jr. drives up on the outside. Kenseth now driving on the inside. The Lepestis rookies are going somewhere. Martin wanted to follow his protege, but when he got to the third corner, he said, I better not do that.
Well, Rusty was in the way. He couldn't get clear in there where he needed to be. Now he's going to try it on the end of the hook. Back. Now he's going to drive. Mark Martin down there making three wide.
And the 32 car of Scott Pruitt, we were told with the tire down. That may have been an incident on pit road with him with contact. There's Pruitt and his tied forward. Left front tire jammed up underneath the left side of that car. Heavy sheet metal damage. He heads back toward pit road.
That's similar to what Jeff Gordon had yesterday when he cut a tire down in practice, and it does a lot of damage. Ward Burton was lucky a while ago to not have more damage to his left front fender than he did have when he cut his tire down.
You know why I was so lucky, Ned? Because the tread came off and stopped. It didn't keep flopping around and knocked the fender off.
Yeah, good point.
How about our rookies in NASCAR Winston Cup competition? Rebestis Rookie of the Year leader, Matt Kenseth. The driver who won here in the spring started 36th. That was Jeff Gordon. And Matt Kenseth started 36th today. You take a look at our Haviland serial scoring on this young man from Wisconsin as he leads it. Wow, 41st on lap 24, all the way to first.
How about our NASCAR Winston Cup points leader, Bobby Labonte, third position. And he's going for second spot right now.
We talked about how the Roush cars guys were laying back a little bit early on in the race, but now a bunch of them are right there at the front. The 17, the 6, the 99 is there.
Bobby Labonte wants those 5 bonus points for leading a lap.
And the 17 car right there gave himself up, I think, for Mark Martin.
And we'll see if Bobby can lead it back to the stripe and he'll get those 5 bonus points. And it looks like he will.
Bobby Labonte, our most recent winner in NASCAR Winston Cup competition last Sunday at Lowe's Motor Speedway, came in leading by 252 points with just 5 events remaining, 4 after today. And Bobby Labonte is leading here with 65 laps to go at Talladega.
3 Pontiacs up front, Bobby Labonte, John Andretti, and the 20 car, Bobby Labonte's teammate,
Tony Stewart.
And you got a Chevrolet back behind them. Then another Pontiac. So Pontiac's running 4 out of the top 5.
The First Ford back there will be back in seventh spot. The big Texaco star on the hood of Ricky Rudd. They fan out now, and Earnhardt Jr. tries to make a move. We'll check in at the Bobby Labonte pits with John Kirby.
Jerry, when Bobby crossed the line with the lead, his crew told him, hey, that's 5 points. That's 5 points. And Bobby radioed back. He says, hey, guys, it's not over yet.
Well, we've had 34 lead changes among 18 drivers, and it is the most we have had all year long. The most number of different drivers, I should say, lead all year long. Previously, we have been in Atlanta where we had 17 different drivers lead, and now we have broken that season record and set a new one. Bobby Labonte from Corpus Christi, Texas, finds himself four races and about 60 laps away from a Winston Cup title.
Kenseth's kind of got rock kicked back to the back, didn't he?
Mm-hmm.
Check letter left.
I don't think so. Green with about 20 laps to go. They pitted on 115. So.
Some of them might get together and try to pit early, short pit, just so pit road won't be so crowded.
Mm-hmm.
Exciting NASCAR action from Talladega, Alabama is being brought to you by the White Track Grand Prix by Pontiac. Whiter is better. By Mobile One, nothing outperforms Mobile One. And by Polaris ATVs. Overdosed on civilization, Polaris is the way out. Right now at Talladega, whiter is better because we've got Pontiacs 1, 2, and 3. And Bobby Labonte, John Andretti, and teammate Tony Stewart trying to hang over the top three spots. Well, you talk about how a race can ebb and flow. Ray, give us an update on the 31 car of Mike Skinner.
Well, Jerry, in the middle of pit road here where I'm working, Skinner's about the only guy that gambled on two tires that time. But when we restarted this race, he was running in second position. Now, he did get shuffled back a little bit, but I think the two-tire strategy may have been too big of a gamble. All the guys that took on four down here now have the option when they pit next time to either do two tires or no tires. And I think anybody that took two tires that last time may be in trouble. And I think Skinner is one of those that could be in trouble. If we stay green here, they'll have to pit with what, about, I'd say, 20 laps to go, right, guys?
Well, that's right, but they must be...
We see the leader, Jerry Nadeau, takes the lead, but Dale Earnhardt Jr. says, that's mine. It's my spot. I want it. I'm going to take it.
And man, he's doing it up there by himself. Then he doesn't have any help. That might cost him as Nadeau figures that out and said, let me get down and get me some help.
Spotters are becoming cheerleaders up on the roof above us watching this as the fans are cheering. Earnhardt using some hand signals there, and that was Jerry Nadeau's radio. A spotter talking to Jerry. Michael Hollick and Chevrolet, as you watch it right along now on the Budweiser onboard for Dale Earnhardt Jr.
Battle for the lead. And it looks like Junior's going to push that 36 car Freighters right to the front. Junior gets aced on the outside as Terry Labonte comes up, brings the big looser on the outside.
Didn't see much of Terry today, but coming to force here now.
Okay, Earnhardt Jr. is strong. Look at him stay in the middle and even pull up a little bit. Four of the last six Winston Cup events have been won by Joe Gibbs Racing. Two for Bobby Labonte, two of the last three for Tony Stewart. And he watches his drivers, hoping that one, Bobby Labonte, is going to be able to hang on and win a Winston Cup title. Let's go down to John Kernan.
And I'm with Coach Joe Gibbs. And Coach, it looks like you might, as you're watching the monitor here, it looks like you might be holding your breath a little bit. In any of your Super Bowls, while coaching the Redskins to the championship, did you ever have to hold your breath?
That's exactly what I'm doing right now. It's just a matter of where you wind up getting shuffled. To see him run three abreast like that, you know, it scares me. I think I'm going to find a quiet place to pray here for a little while.
How does it compare molding a championship race team to putting together a championship football team? Or is there a good comparison?
I said to everybody that you know, it's almost exactly the same number of people. It's just as hard, if not harder. We've never won a championship over here, so that's what we're fighting for. That's why all this makes us so nervous. But it's exactly the same because you win with people. You don't win with cars or X's and O's.
Well, that's how they have built a championship team, and we'll let him get back to watching the monitor so he can continue to hold his breath, as we all are down here on pit road.
1996 inductee in the National Football League Professional Football Hall of Fame. Talking about Joe Gibbs, three Super Bowl victories and four trips. Well, Mike Skinner is pedaling toward the front, or trying to, Ray Dunlap.
With Jerry on the radio, Skinner says those two tires weren't a problem at all. The car feels great. Best it's driven all day long. Well, how long that'll last, who knows? But boy, as he worked his way back up, you talk about ebb and flow. He went from 27th all the way up now where he might have a shot at taking the lead.
And we haven't talked much about the guy running the second, Benny Parsons, but what a job.
Yeah, Terry Labonte's done a terrific job. Labonte started in 17th position, has worked his way up to second spot.
Tony Stewart, apparently a problem for the Home Depot Pontiac. Let's go to John.
About a half lap ago, Tony Stewart radioed his crew and said, hey, she's loaded up, something's going on here. So they're bringing him in, they're changing all four tires, should be able to go to the end of the race now, but it depends on how he comes out on the pack. As and he kills the engine, but he refires it and is on his way. So we'll see if he can catch up with the pack. He may be in big danger of losing a lap if he's out there running by himself, but he should be able to go the rest of the way.
Well, he's certainly going to lose a lap, there's no doubt about that. Here comes the pack off the corner, and he, about the time he gets up to speed, the pack will be coming to catch him. There he is, going down to turn one, and here comes the big pack of cars. He's running about 80 miles an hour, and they're running about 190 miles per hour, and of course, they're about three or four wide.
They'll catch him going into turn three, coming off of turn four.
Terry Labonte, that last lap, led the race in the Kellogg Chevrolet.
And also back on pit road to car number 7, you Michael Waltrip fans back in the pits. And more from the Tony Stewart pits with John Kermit.
Jerry, the problem was the left rear, a few of the lug nuts had worked their way loose because you could see on the wheel how the holes, instead of being perfectly round, they were kind of oblonged out as the tire vibrated just a little bit. But they caught it, got him in before he had a problem, got the tire changed, the lugs tied on this wheel, and they can go the rest of the way.
Folks, we talked about a record race today. It has been 14 years since we've had 19 or more different drivers lead a race. When did that happen? Right here at Talladega back in July of 1986. There have been 19 different drivers in this race today leading. And we've still got a ways to go. 52 laps.
Here goes Tony Stewart going a lap down. Terry Labonte out front up on the outside.
Now we see his teammate Bobby Labonte come up on the inside, try to get hooked up with the Home Depot Pontiac.
Looking from high above, courtesy of the fine folks at Pennzoil on our Pennzoil copter cam, giving you a bird's eye view of this massive 2.66 mile facility. And folks, there are still 32 cars on the lead lap, and they are within a second of the leader. That's how close it is with 51 laps to go. Four races remain after this one today. And 36-year-old Bobby Labonte trying to hang on for a championship while his brother Terry Labonte would like to go to victory lane at Talladega in today's Winston 500. Back with more live coverage in just a moment. At Talladega Super Speedway with Texas Terry showing the way. 140 laps in the books, 48 laps to go. If you just joined us, there are just four cars out of it. Kevin LePage has had engine problems after Jeremy Mayfield and Sterling Marlin. Dave Marcus brought the first caution flag today on lap 103 with engine problems. This car rolled to a halt. The 26 car, Jimmy Spencer, has been off the racetrack with a broken shock absorber. He is back on the track some 29 laps behind. And the 32 car, just a moment ago, Scott Pruitt, has gone behind the wall. He cut a tire and had some sheet metal and front end damage. They are working on his car, the tired Ford.
And so far, we've had 38 lead changes. I told you, we averaged 35, a little bit more than average today. One more lead change. Dale Earnhardt, the green car, goes back to first class in Labonte. And we see on the outside, Jerry Nadeau, trying to go by that road.
three deep, three wide for about three rows of cars, four rows of cars there.
The last time we had this many drivers leading races, I told you, was 14 years ago. On that day, in July of 1986, we had a first-time winner. Bobby Hiller got his first Winston Cup victory.
On board with Dale Earnhardt Jr., the Budweiser Chevrolet, as he looks back at a couple other Chevrolets. On your right, Mike Skinner. On your left, Jeff Gordon. All this is at 190 miles per hour. Nadeau comes down, tries to take the lead with help from Matt Kenseth.
Winston Cup race. This is his 99th career start, dropping this year for Rick Hendrick. Michael Holligan, .com Chevy.
Clear by two, yeah.
You know, Ben, it's amazing to me is how stable these cars look at these speeds and running three wide. In the past, we've seen them run three wide, but you know, the middle car was usually pretty squirrely, and sometimes even those on the inside would be squirrely as well. But these cars seem pretty stable. I guess it's because of all that downforce that they put on with the new roots.
How did these guys just drive by in the middle? Was it Kenseth that helped these guys? Earnhardt Jr., they drive by Nadeau. All of a sudden, does Nadeau have a problem? No, it doesn't look that way.
Just the grass. But it is. It worked better for that group in the middle.
And Denny, we have watched Dale Earnhardt Jr. come up to that middle time. Time again to get shuffled back. He jumps back in that throttle on Richie Gilmore engine and just roars back toward the front.
And Elliott Sadler, he goes blowing by and takes the lead.
Well, but he laid down.
I'm sorry, Ned.
Yeah, he made an unscheduled pit stop not long after the green came out.
Oh, so. Thank you.
According to the scoring, he's not a lap down. I swear I thought I saw him come out of the pits, but maybe not. Maybe I'm seeing things here with all those sick little cars out there.
Well, anyway, Mark Martin, wherever he came from, he's now in the lead. Forget about the 21, because he's old news.
Mark Martin, who led so many laps here back in the spring, back in April. In fact, he led the most laps, seven times for 98 laps, only to be shuffled and finished back in 15th position.
You know, we cover happy hour at most of these NASCAR Winston Cup races that ESPN does. And Mark Martin usually practices more laps than anyone else. But yesterday, he only practiced 14 laps. And I asked the coach, Jimmy Finney was more than one. He said, well, the car was driving good. That good. He said, what the heck? No, he's wrecking this afternoon. I'll wait tomorrow and wreck. So far, he hasn't wrecked.
Jimmy's always a man of few words, but he gets his point across.
Yes, he does.
43 laps to go here at Talladega. I'm Jerry Parks, along with Benny Parsons, Ned Jarrett, and a great crew on pit road. Bill Weber, John Kernan, and Ray Dunlap covering action, and there will be one more pit stop. When it'll happen? Well, if we stay green, we're looking at about 20 to 25 laps to go, and they have to make that final stop.
I tell you what, you would have thought when that tire shredded on the left front of Ward Burton's car and it stopped rolling and he banged it on up trying to get back to clear, it would have hurt the car in some way, shape, or form. But it doesn't seem to have hurt it a bit because here he is in second spot.
Well, that's amazing. I never thought he'd be able to be that competitive again after that.
Exactly. If you're sitting on the sofa at home, you looked at your wife and said, where'd he come from? Which is exactly what we said a moment ago. Laps are winding down. Mark Martin is our leader here at Talladega. Stay with us.
Maybe I saw him come down pit road during the caution. Okay. Maybe that's where I saw him. Thank you. Sorry I messed you guys up on that.
Well, wasn't he leading coming off two over there?
Yeah.
And the time we got through discussion about whether he was in the lead or not, he was about third.
Yeah, that was good. Pickup said he's old news now.
I swear he was leading coming off two. Next time I looked up, he was third.
Yeah. team are riding far enough back there that that victory does come, that they can hopefully get slowed down and dodge it.
Is that Burton up high on the outside about going on losing all those spots? I don't know. Too much excitement back here.
Maybe we'll get a chance to talk about Elliott in a minute if he gets back up there. He's hanging.
I guess that was the 21 car was being shuffled back.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
Hold it.
Back at Talladega, patience beginning to wear thin as the laps wind down. Here at Hold Your Breath NASCAR action, Talladega style. Taking a hold of your breath, there goes Dale Earnhardt Jr. to the high side. Here comes Gordon on the inside of Mark Martin.
Johnny Benson trying to help Mark Martin go through. Trying to help Jeff Gordon go by Mark Martin, I should say. And I'm telling you what, these guys go to the back, to the front. They get hustled to the back to the front. Jeff Gordon has been back and forth more than a yo-yo today.
Became our 42nd lead change here at Talladega. Just 38 laps to go.
We had 45 lead changes last week at the Lowe's Motor Speedway in that race, which I think was the most of the season.
Now we talked about the 22 car of Ward Burton, the problems he had, and now he is back up there among the leaders. Let's check in his pits with John Kernan.
And I'm with Ward's crew chief, Tommy Baldwin. And Tommy, considering all the aerodynamic work you had to do to that car, are you surprised that it's running as well as it is?
Yeah, kind of. You know, that left front fender is still flopping around in the air. We're hoping for a caution so we can fix it, get a little bit better. But, you know, car's real strong. Terry Ellidge and the motor guys did an excellent job putting the motor together today. And hopefully we get caught in the right traffic, just caterpillar fire and get back up front, get a good pit stop, and see where we end up with a beat-up car.
I don't know, you might want to take that beat-up car to the wind tunnel, check the numbers, and the same configuration for the Daytona next year. It's running so good.
I highly doubt it. The car's pretty much beat up, balanced about 6 inches in the air, hood's all beat up, fender's flopping. It's not very good right now. He's complaining on the radio, but there's nothing I can do right now. You just have to drive it and hang on.
All right, well, we'll let you get back to watching the race, Tommy. Jerry?
Thanks, John. Watch it. The car number 8. Look at the left side of your screen there. That's Jerry Nadeau. He's been running way up on the very top of the racetrack. And the 10 car, Johnny Benson. Remember Benson from the season opener? He came within 4 laps of winning the Daytona 500.
Well, they've got back to that battle for about 5th spot. They've got them all lined up 3 wide, but every one of them has someone on the back coming to help. But right now, the battle is for, I guess, 2nd spot, with Earnhardt lined up in the middle. Dale Jr. in front of his dad. And on the outside is Nadeau. On the inside is the 10 car of Benson.
Coach, I told you at the top of the show, if you have seatbelt on your sofa, you better buckle up. Imagine if you're on the edge of your seat at home what these guys are feeling like. 31 cars, 2 seconds apart, with less than 40 laps to go at 190-plus miles an hour, folks. This is NASCAR racing at its finest. Ned mentioned the fans were raving last week about that great race at Lowe's Motor Speedway, 46 lead changes among 13 different drivers. Well, today we have had 43 lead changes among 20 drivers, and we still have 37 laps to go.
You know, we talked at the first broadcast about the middle lane maybe was not the place to be, but now it's working very well.
Ned, it just seems to ebb and flow. It seems like it doesn't work, and all of a sudden something happens and it does work. The outside line, we talked about how it didn't work, and all of a sudden we've seen cars just get blown by on the outside. As we see Dale Earnhardt going the inside of his son to take over that 2nd spot.
Fans are on their feet screaming and waving hats. They're watching what you're watching as they come flashing by.
And now we'll watch from above, courtesy of the folks at Pennzoil in our Pennzoil Copter Cam. Here they come, a gaggle of cars, 31 of them.
Johnny Benson was running second just a moment ago. He's on the inside with not really any drafting help. That time by, he had fallen back to the 10th position, and Jeff is losing more spots.
How about Jeff Burton? Penalized 15 seconds for a crew member over the wall. Back to 42nd spot. Now he's right back among this group battling for the lead.
He had a huge break when he got a caution flag, and he's right back in it now.
We are hearing 10 to 15 laps. The final pit stops will be coming. And we'll let you catch your breath. We'll catch our breath. And we will come back and cover those final pit stops. Critical pit road area as the crew members watch and wait to know their work can impact the winner. Back in a moment.
Yeah. Of course, Junior's not going to ride behind his dad long, is he?
Nope.
I bet his dad's hot right now, don't you? Don't you know Dale is?
Yeah.
Oh, what was that? Oh, gee whiz.
What,
man.
What? Yeah, shock broke. Wow. Shocking revelation and happy.
He's not. He won't be.
Unless he, no,
he
yeah.
Make a heck of a run if he does.
It's the last car on the lead lap, 4 seconds back. Has he got a problem on
him? No, I think he's riding.
Just riding?
I really think, I might be wrong, but.
Think DJ and he are back there riding?
That's how I think. Bobby Labonte was back there ripping wild not 10 laps ago, and there he is on the second. Yep. Yep, exactly.
Who's in the middle? Is that Bickle in the middle?
Tony Stewart in third.
Well, welcome back to Talladega Super Speedway. Take a deep breath and watch what's about to unfold here in these final laps. 44 lead changes among 20 drivers. We still have one pit stop to go. That's coming up in about 7 or 8 laps. And there's the points leader up close and personal. That big Interstate Batteries hood for Bobby Labonte, right behind Dale Earnhardt Jr. Well, first car on the pit road will be the car number 10, the Aaron's Rents Pontiac for Johnny Benson, James Ensign Company. Will they do a gas and go? Let's watch.
At least right side tires.
Now they will not have to have a full tank of fuel because they only have about 20 laps to go. But they're going to change all four.
I really believe that Benson's car all of a sudden they lost the handle on the car, so they're going to make some adjustments and change four tires, hoping to get something better. And he can get lucky, and all the rest of the cars have to make their pit stop before, to say, a caution flag comes up, because he is going to lose the lap.
Pedaling hard as he can, but obviously with that play, here come the leaders at 190, and Benson is probably less than 100 miles an hour coming off of pit road. Talladega Super Speedway. Now there's the car number 94. A moment ago, we were talking about Bill Elliott back there. He is the last car, or was the last car on the lead lap, but he's back there with the 88 car for Dale Jarrett. You gotta wonder what they're doing.
Well, I think they were riding. They saw all that action going on up in front of them, and I think that they said, hey, let's just sit back here and ride in case that big one happens. You know, we'll be in position maybe to get slowed down. The DJ, I think, has decided to punch his, and he's coming back up through there.
He must have changed songs in the CD player. He's just driving to a totally different tune this lap than he was about the last seven or eight laps. Now, what about the 10-car pit stop coming in early, Ray Dunlap?
Well, Jerry, Johnny came on the radio, said he had a bad vibration, thought he was getting a right rear tire going down. They are checking them right now, and it appears that all the tires do have air in them. But, hey, if it doesn't feel good out there, probably the best move for the driver to bring it in so it doesn't go in the fence.
Junior showing the way here at Talladega as we get closer and closer to pit stops. Earnhardt Jr., a two-time winner already this year. One at Texas back on April 2nd. One at Richmond back on May the 6th. There's a second pack led by Ricky Love, who's gone over 2 years now since his last victory. Coming in Martinsville back in the spring of 98.
And right now, Bobby LeBron has got to be loving running the second spot.
Single file.
Single file. Has his teammate Tony Stewart behind him. He knows that Tony's a lap down, and he knows Tony's not going to do something to him. Take a chance on hitting the 18 car. So life is grand for Bobby Labonte right now.
Well, the crews are talking about waiting a little bit for pit stops, so we'll take a quick break and come back and cover those final pit stops of the day. Green flag pit stops coming up. Earnhardt Jr., Bobby Labonte. They do Earnhardt. That's a top four.
Look at Skinner.
Boy, Skinner, he almost got the four car. You see that? Man. Mike. Think about it, big guy. Goodness. Guess I'm going to write this down. 61.
Well, I mean,
there's several laps.
Yeah, it won't be the next lap or two.
B-Y-R-U-M, Byram.
Okay.
Byram.
Three-way tie for second. Okay. Back at Talladega Super Speedway, there have been no pit stops among the leaders. A moment ago, the 99 car on pit road for a stop. He made two right side tire change with all the possibility of tire going down. Now, coming up next, the PGA Las Vegas Invitational. Tom Byram, our leader, but it's a three-way tie for second spot. We're going out for the Las Vegas Invitational PGA event at the conclusion of our live coverage of NASCAR action from Talladega.
During our break, the 99 car of Jeff Burton made, I guess, an unscheduled pit stop, changed right side tires, and is now back on the racetrack.
Now, he was going to have to stop anyway, Benny, but the fact that he did not have anybody to run with once he got back out on the racetrack, and the leaders are coming up on him now to put him a lap down. And so he's lost perhaps a second lap to the leaders. So even if they stop behind him, it still is going to hurt him because they'll have cars to run with.
There's a look at Jeff Burton and the leaders right behind him. Take a look at his bumper cam on the Parts Plus see, here comes Earnhardt Jr. coming right at him. Bill Weber?
Well, Jeff Burton, as the leaders roar by him, had to come in. He felt he had a vibration. They changed right side tires, looked at the lefts. The left looked okay. They took the rights off. The rights appear to be fine. So Burton had a vibration. That's why he pit it early. But they told him when he gets on the track to try and hang with Tony Stewart, because Stewart does not have to stop.
And the car number 36, Kenny Schrader. He'll be having to make a pit stop anyway, but he's obviously slowing down from that lead pack. And this probably is going to be an unscheduled stop. He's slowing down considerably and did not come down pit road.
Well, he's down in one and two right now. And if you look by our microphone down there, it's sounding to me like it might be on seven cylinders. But if Schrader has a problem and he chose not to make a pit stop, evidently he feels like he's going to ride it out.
And we've been told it definitely is an engine problem. So good ears, Benny, on hearing that car when he came by. 23 laps to go. Any time now. These cars, we last pitted on lap 115. So 50 laps ago, they made their pit stop.
And we haven't seen them go much more than 50 laps here today. And they don't need to stretch it because all they got to do is come in and get enough fuel to go to the end of the way. It'll be interesting to see who changes tires and who doesn't.
How many gas it goes will have, how many two-tire changes.
And Dale Earnhardt, the three car, has been up front all day long, but right now he seems to be struggling. He's falling back to the 19th position. So if he does have a handling problem, there we see Earnhardt. Can he make the gas and go? I mean, he's probably going, if he has a handling problem, he's probably going to have to change four tires and put that splash of fuel, which will take him a lot longer than some of these other cars.
And remember, Earnhardt only changed two tires on that pit stop on lap 115. He chose to change two. The 94 car of Elliott didn't make a tire change. He needed it a two car of Rusty Wallace. So that may explain why the 94 car is going toward the back of the pack. There's a 27 car. Good effort by Barry Dotson, that whole Jack Birmingham Eel River Racing crew from Mike Blitz.
Some of the folks were saying that maybe Bliss only took fuel the last time, did not change tires at all. I'm really not sure if it's two tires or no tires, but whichever. He's doing a pretty good job. At this racetrack at Talladega, tires has never been a problem as far as handling is concerned, a big problem like it is at some other racetracks.
He saw some arms waving in the windows that are indicative that maybe some guys may be slowing down. We'll see if anybody peels off down the pit road. This time, they still come roaring by. And the 36 car, by the way.
Oh, we got a crash.
Tommy Hamilton in the inside wall. Jeff Gordon down pit road. Mark Martin loops it around. The 94 car of Bill Elliott makes it by.
And some heavy damage to Bobby Hamilton's car.
And tough break for Jeff Burton and Tony Stewart, who were not going to have to stop. The others were going to have to stop soon under green flag conditions. And here's Jeff Gordon. He was coming down pit road. He'll probably be up near the front of the pack.
He'll probably lead the race if this thing restarts.
Probably will.
They'll have to all come down a pit.
I tell you what, pretty good. He wrecked on the pit road and had to stop, put fuel in. Not bad.
Good break. He's had bad breaks. There's Bobby Hamilton getting out of his car. See a lot of damage to that Chevrolet.
There's a six car of Mark Martin. Some damage in the left rear. Some speculation. Maybe some cars slowing to come onto pit road may have caused this little backup air and these spins up in turn four. So we can see what happened just a moment ago.
Come off the corner. There's Hamilton on the inside, and the car on the inside is going to make a pit stop. I guess that's Mark Martin was going to make a pit stop. And Jeff Gordon had already decided to make a pit stop. He's not involved in the crash. I thought he was involved in the crash, and he was coming down pit road.
So that was a tremendous break for him.
And after Jeff Gordon entered pit road, the pit road closed. He could get that fuel illegally.
Now for Mark Martin's onboard camera. Up in turn three, in the middle of three and four. Martin puts it back in gear once again.
Well, you can see the closing rate. We see Mark Martin up on the outside, and he goes down between two cars. And Hamilton had just such a run. He closed on him so rapidly that when Mark decided to go in the pits, there was nothing that Bobby could do except run the back of it.
Mike Bliss and, what is that, Bickle, the 60 car, the black car there of Rich Bickle, and the 27 car, I believe, got together. And a little bit of squirreliness there.
Right, one more angle. We'll take a look from the outside of turn four to see the contact there.
There's the 27 and the 60, and that's talking about as they both try to slide by.
Well, they have closed pit road because they're still working to be able to get some of the cars off of pit road to get the Bobby Hamilton car pulled in. As you watch, again, the replay, trying to get all of pit road completely clear before they open up pit road and let these guys come scrambling on for that final pit stop.
Now, Mark Martin just came out of the pits. Maybe he had to. Pit road will be open this time around, but he... with the damage that he has, he felt that he probably needed to come on in and get the work done. And if he did pit while it was closed, then he would have to go to the end of the longest line, I guess, from restart.
Talk about rather being lucky than good. Well, Jeff Gordon has been both today. He's been good and lucky. And good and lucky there, was able to come down pit road and make that pit stop before the pits closed. And now, with less than 20 laps to go in Talladega, this should be the final pit stop, at least scheduled pit stop of the day, as the leaders peel off at 55 miles an hour and head down to you, John Kernan.
And it'll be only two tires for Bobby Labonte. Car loose on entry, so they put a half pound of air pressure in the right front. So Bobby's away.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. is in. A two-tire stop here. Right side. Has to slow down to try to get in. It is gas only for Steve Park. Now to Bill Weber.
Two right sides for Dale Earnhardt and fuel. No car in front of him. A quick stop. He's on his way.
There you see Bill Elliott's crew. Remember, he did not make a tire change. They will put four tires on the car number 94. There's the damage on the left rear of the car number 6.
And Elliott finally gets those four tires changed. He's back on the racetrack following Ted Musgrave, the Bell South car, and they continue to try to straighten out this left rear quarter panel on the Valvoline Ford of Mark Martin.
All right, some of the crew there for Jack Roush Racing using the hammer to try to beat some of that sheet metal away. Third caution flag of the day. Back with more live coverage in just a moment.
Bill brings up a good point. If the 24 car had been able to react really quick, they'd have changed four tires.
Yeah. They had plenty of time. That's a good point.
I mean, we said that he did a good job while he was going down pit road to miss the wreck, but he was going down. I didn't realize until we started to saw the replay.
Yeah.
That's what his intentions were all along. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I wonder if they didn't have four tires ready.
Not a bad. Well, Lynn, I mentioned the 20 and the 99. But I mentioned the 20 and the 99, but I didn't think about the 10 and the 7. They were in the same boat. They could have gone the rest of the way.
Okay. All right.
I thought it was going to be a lot worse when I first saw that four car go sideways.
Mm-hmm.
Boy.
Our 29-year-old three-time Winston Cup champion, Jeff Gordon, is also a three-time winner of the No Bull 5 bonus, but he has not won the No Bull 5 million in the year 2000. His wins came in 98 and 99. But he is leading here with less than 20 laps to go. That's where the five contenders are running. Earnhardt back in 15th. Martin, who had that damaged left rear in 26th spot. Steve Park up in 8th. And Jeff Burton back in 29th position. We'll come back with more live coverage of the Winston 500 presented by UPS from Talladega in just a moment.
Hey, Neil. Are the golf fans going to get some bonus coverage? No. Okay. Okay.
Okay.
What are we scheduled? 4:30?
Four.
Four. Take four.
A face? That's a face? Oh,
yeah.
that's Boo.
That's Boo.
Oh, Boo. Sorry. I don't know what I was seeing.
That,
yeah.
Boo Whitaker, huh?
I just didn't understand what I was seeing. Need to promo the ARCA race again, too. Got that big, exciting thing coming up. Oh, you didn't hear me? What time is it, the ARCA race?
5 o'clock.
5 o'clock?
5 o'clock.
Eastern on the deuce.
We're coming back with Boo Whitaker, then the Coke pit summary, then the replay. Back at Talladega Super Speedway, I'm Jerry Punch along with Ned Jarrett, Benny Parsons, Bill Weber, Ray Dunlap, and John Kernan in the pits. Now, a moment ago, these teams made what was hopefully their final pit stop of the day. Take a look from Boo Whitaker's standpoint.
He's the rear tire changer on Joe Nemechek's car. So stop, stop, stop. Why is the Boo changing the tire? Oh, it's gas only. Boo stays over and just cheers.
Our Coke pit summary shows you. How about a big gain for Jeff Gordon? Wouldn't you expect it in 26th, out first? Well, we'll tell you how that happened a moment ago. He was actually coming on the pit road when the caution came out. Rudd, fourth to second. First to third for Earnhardt. Skinner gained 9 spots, and Bobby Labonte lost 3.
Folks, watch this. Coming off the corner, Mark Martin, Bobby Hamilton make contact. And Jeff Gordon was pitting. I thought that he had gone down pit road to avoid the crash. He was making a pit stop. The caution comes out because of those guys spinning. Jeff Gordon is in the pits, makes his pit stop. Gas only. Now, if those guys had really been sharp, they would have changed 4 tires because he would have still been leading the race with 4 fresh tires.
He had plenty of time to do that, but they were primed and positioned to put gas in it.
That's right. They were geared to put gas only, and again, probably did not have 4 tires ready to go. I wouldn't have either. It's only after starting 5 minutes later you think about why you put tires in.
All right, green flag waves once again. Jeff Gordon, who won it here in April, trying to pull off the Talladega sweep.
And Jerry, there you see Michael Walker down on the inside. That was sort of a bad break. He and Johnny Benson, who are all those cars, plus Jeff Burton and Tony Stewart, were set to go the rest of the way. And others going to have to stop under green for this incident, so that took them a lap down. We didn't get them back, and so that really hurt for that car to hurt them.
Jeff Gordon, Ricky Rudd, Earnhardt Jr., Skinner, Bobby Labonte, the points leader, Rusty is there. Still 27 cars on the lead lap, with 15 laps to go at Talladega.
So if something happens to your car right now, you have a flat tire, you're still going to have a bad finish. You're still going to finish 28th or worse. If they all run to the end, 188 laps, and they might not.
Ricky Rudd looking to the inside. Rudd took on fuel only, no tire changes, a little mixing it up there in the back, as you see.
Well, we're going to see who's been riding and who's been racing. He turned the steer cutter on the inside of Ricky Rudd. Ricky didn't need that, but it helped.
Bobby Labonte and Jeff Gordon almost get together. And now Gordon was the leader as they crossed the line. He's in the middle, going back to about 10th spot. And cars going every place on the outside, inside of him.
Now, Dale Jr. is in the lead.
Junior, we mentioned he has two wins, but he has not had a top 10 finish. It's Dover back in on June 4th. He has struggled the past 2.5 months in Winston Cup competition. Let's check in with Ray.
And guys, Dale Jr. just came on the radio and he said, tell Bobby to hit me really hard and maybe the two of us can bump draft and get away from this group. Tell him to come up and give me a shot in the bumper.
Ned, what do you think? Would you want to be leading or in second spot?
I don't know.
We've seen some passes made awfully easy.
Yeah, we have.
But we've seen some that are made very difficult.
Yes, we have. I think it would depend. I think I'd rather be leading. Really, I'd rather be leading on that last lap. I'd probably wind up and be wrong, but they're going to be racing for that second spot, and that's going to help the leader.
Well, look at this mess, Ned. Up on the high side is Terry Labonte hung up there. Behind him is Earnhardt. We saw Steve Park get a little bit loose a moment ago and wobble in the middle of the corner. And that Penske Chevrolet, he held on. Now we have 46 lead changes among 20 drivers, tying the most lead changes here in the year 2000. Last week's race at Lowe's Motor Speedway, they had 46 lead changes among 13 drivers, and Bobby Labonte won that one. Up second starting spot, and right now Bobby is running second.
I think he likes his position there, as many said earlier, for a number of reasons.
Oh, and Gordon goes down on the apron of the racetrack to pass Matt Kenseth, or I should say, to attempt to pass Matt Kenseth. He has not been able to put a blade on that DuPont Chevrolet. He can mow the grass next time by. He's down right near the grass on the apron of the racetrack.
Nemechek trying to figure out how to get by the 21 car of Elliott Saturday. He goes down in the middle with help from Mike Bliss. And that just might work. It looks like it's going to.
Six, John Andretti in the 43 car right behind him. A great run by Steve Grissom in that 44 car.
And that's good to see. That team has had a tough time this year, and Steve proving once again that he can drive a race car.
Yeah, as good as you feel for Steve Grissom, Ned, you also feel as well for the team because it has been a struggle. And Mark Martin is still out there. Let's see, where is Mark Martin running?
Hey, he's running in eighth position.
Well, there's no quitting Mark Martin. Not a single bone in his body says quit. He will fight until the checkered flag wave.
You know, I think when I said that he had just come out of the pits, I think that he might have fallen under the same grandfather's rule that Jeff Gordon did, and that he was not penalized for pitting when the pits were closed because he came on down pit road and he got his service done.
Now, Rodney Wise have told him it was 10 to go, and now, if you've got a gun, it's time to fire it.
And Rusty somehow stuck that Miller Lite Ford between Nemechek and the 55 car of Kenny Walsh. Maybe it was a 22 car. I don't know. I didn't think there was room, but Rusty went in there, and sure enough, the ocean party. Just touching that, got his foot riding on the brake just in case. But he needs to brake quickly.
Less and 10 laps to go, and now 27 cars, 2.5 seconds apart. It's still anybody's race at Talladega.
Look at Mark Martin coming high, way high up off of turn four. He's got a little bit of help from Dale Jarrett and Jeff Gordon back there. They had come three wide through three and four.
Back in third position. Look at that high side. There's Jeff Gordon up there.
It looks like Gordon is getting shuffled to the rear. And that's what Dale Jr. was talking about. On the straightaways, run up and hit me hard. Get this thing going. It's going faster around this racetrack. Last time by, they ran a little over 188 miles per hour. That's quicker than we saw about in the middle race, around 185, much quicker.
As you look down from above, our pins all caught for camp. We told you the top of the show. They want the headlines tomorrow to read at Talladega. Grown men use slingshots to bring the fans to their feet. And that's what we're probably going to see here in the next seven laps. Will Bobby Labonte bump him, or will he bump, fake a bump and make a run to the inside?
He's sizing him up right now. So, hey, when do I need to move? Can I make a move?
Remember, Mike Skinner back there in third spot has never won in 140 Winston Cup starts. 1997 Rookie of the Year, driving the low Chevrolet, finished second here in April. Said he learned a lot in those final laps when he lost to Jeff Gordon. He learned enough possibly to win one next time. Well, guess what? It's next time for Mike Skinner. Let's see what plays out here in these final six laps.
For about 15 spot, he was four wide going through one and two just a moment ago. Guess what? But he's still four wide. Nadeau on the outside. Rich Bickle on the inside.
It'll be five to go this time by. One handful waved by Rodney Wise from the flag stand. Five laps away from the checkered flag and a 30-second run to the Winston 500.
Front group there are protecting that inside. Every one of them. They've seen cars try to take a shot at him up on the high side. Did Earnhardt make contact with somebody there?
He was on the inside of Rich Bickle, and they're going to the grass. All the way, Earnhardt, if you're going to pass him on the inside, it's going to be on the grass, Ned. He's down on the very bottom of the racetrack. And Mark Martinell is on the high side. He's getting shuffled way back.
Let's show you what happened a moment ago with Earnhardt there on the left side of your screen. Watch the three car.
That's Rich Bickle on his outside. They go down in the corner, and all three cars touch. Rusty Walsh and Bickle touch with Bickle's right side, Earnhardt's right side, and Bickle's left side touch.
Now less than five to go. Look at this pack of cars. Here comes Skinner on the outside. He faked the move to the inside. Will he have a drafting partner? He is now dead even, door-to-door with Bobby Labonte.
He's got John Andretti up there and other cars that have fallen on that outside line there now. That inside has not been protected the way it was.
I told you the last time we had this many different leaders, we saw a first-time winner. Whoa!
He is now on the grass. He really was on the grass, folks. And he didn't have mud tires. He was,
wow, at 190 miles per hour, he was on the grass in the backstretch.
Earnhardt trying to come up through the middle.
And Skinner has taken the lead. Going in turn three, it's Skinner with the lead.
I started to say the last time we had this many lead changes, we ended up with a first-time winner at Talladega. It was Bobby Hill in that day. Will it be Mike Skinner today? Here comes John Andretti. The Cheerios Pontiac flashing by.
Oh, no, he's on the inside, John. He's on the inside.
Now they're four wide for the lead. Well, for second it is now.
Four abreast. Talking about first-time winner, Skinner trying to hang on. Earnhardt Jr. is a
two-time winner this year. Now they are five wide with three laps to go at Talladega.
Now there ain't three laps of green flag. There ain't no way they can run three laps like this.
Hold your breath, folks. Less than three laps to go. Who's going to win it? 47 lead changes, 21 different drivers. Mark Martin trying to plow his way through a minefield of race cars at 190 miles an hour. And here comes Earnhardt.
How did he get through all these cars? How he did that?
The Intimidator is scraped and beaten on the right side. But he will not be denied. Mr. Restrictor Plate knows there are two left to go. Earnhardt climbs on the high side of Bobby Labonte. Wow. You see him motioning. He's motioning the 55 car of Kenny Wallace to give me a bump. Come on, Kenny, give me a shove.
And Earnhardt is going for the lead.
And listen to this crowd of 170,000 strong.
Richard Childress makes his cars running 1-2 as he comes for the white flag. He's on the apron of the racetrack, Ned.
He saves a race car up almost against Bobby Labonte. Dale Earnhardt Sr. has come from 17th spot in four laps to lead it on the final lap.
But Kenny Wallace is in second spot, followed by
his teammate,
Joe Nemechek.
Nemechek with the pole center. And Kenny Wallace has likewise never won a Winston Cup race. Three Chevrolets on the final lap at Talladega. $2.7 million and $1 million bonus for Dale Earnhardt if he can hang on. The No Ball 5 contender, Mr. Restrictor Plate, Dale Earnhardt, comes down and will take his 10th career victory at Talladega in the Winston 500.
The crash as the team across the start-finish line.
Slipping and sliding everywhere across the racetrack as the checkered flag waves. The 22 is involved. Warren Burton was involved. The 9 car was sliding.
The 44 of Steve Grissom was sliding.
AC Compton was involved. And there, that big fist out the window, Earnhardt pulls up and says, thank you, Kenny Wallace. Because Kenny was right on his bumper and gave him the shove. And the shove actually was right by Earnhardt's teammate, Mike Skip. Let's go down to the Earnhardt pit and hear from his car owner, Richard Childress.
Guys, you will not believe it. Richard Childress walked over and gave Danny Lawrence a big old kiss. Is that the most unbelievable race you've ever seen?
Unbelievable, but it was Kevin Hamlin. His back's hurting so bad, you can't touch him. Hey, the race fans today got the race they deserve. This is for the race fans, Goodrich, everybody.
Talladega has been Dale Earnhardt's track, but that may be the most impressive run I've ever seen.
That was wild. You know, we never gave up. He wanted some tires to tighten him up. It was just wonderful. Hey, I got to thank this whole race team. Mike Skinner done a super job today in the Lowe's car. You know, he's going to win his race.
Absolutely. What an unbelievable finish, guys.
Well, the most lead changes in over a decade, the most leaders in 14 years. And if you're a NASCAR fan, you love this one. If you weren't a NASCAR fan, you became one today. But 170,000 strong stood and cheered. They got to be exhausted. Many of them haven't sat down all day long. Let's take a look at what happened here in the final seconds of this one at Talladega.
Well, they go across the line, and somewhere back here on that five abreast is just going to catch up with them. We see Rich Bickle go sideways, the 22 car. I think I see the one car of Steve Park going around. And then all the cars get obscured in the smoke, and I can't tell who's
Ward,
what.
Ward Burton is definitely in it. He's getting his car back to the garage.
Here's Ward, you come down to the line.
Too many cars trying to get in the same place.
Jeff Burton, was he involved? Let's see. Comes off turn four. Come on, goes by the line. No, he did save a race car.
Yeah.
Well, here's the way they were. They came across, and this cluster of race cars coming for the checkered flag. But the 32nd annual Winston 500 is history, and the Intimidator, Dale Earnhardt, is on his way to victory lane. They scramble, they push, they shove, and the checkered flag had already waved. We'll be back in just a moment. NASCAR Heat Winner Circle.
Unbelievable. Steve Grissom was in that wreck.
Yeah.
You say it is Bill, correct?
Earnhardt was about like Jeff Gordon here the last time. I don't know how he got through all that crowd of cars.
He's the master.
And Slob, most lead changes since 89. Is that right?
There were 49 in 89, so how many you got?
49. Today, a 49-year-old seven-time Winston Cup champion would not be denied. He had come seven times to the Noble table, but had never won the million-dollar bonus. But today, he will win the million-dollar bonus and the lion's share of a record $2.7 million purse. Let's go down to our Hasbro NASCAR Heat Winner Circle. Here's Bill Winner.
Couple of big winners and two new millionaires. Well, Earnhardt already had a little bit of money. But he's a winner at Talladega for the 10th time in fantastic fashion. I have seen you celebrate before, but this was pretty wild.
Come on up here, Frank.
Be careful with him.
I am. It was wild. I didn't have any thought that I'd have a chance of winning this race, starting where I did on that restart. Boy, as we kept working away and got on the outside, Kenny Wallace really worked hard with us, and he done a good job. I don't think we would have got back up there if it wasn't for Kenny.
Did you get back up there?
He stayed with me. Once we got together, he stayed with me, and he pushed me to the outside of them guys, and I had to beat Mike Skinner, but I had to beat him for a million.
You were very vocal yesterday, Dale, that you don't particularly care for this rule package. Did it frustrate you during the day?
Oh, it was very frustrating. Nobody could stay in front, and it was a chess game of getting there and staying there, and it just worked out for us to be there at the right time.
Have you ever won the Winston million-dollar bonus before?
It's the first time I've won it. I've been eligible several times, so it'd be good going to Vegas now with $1 million in my pocket, huh?
And obviously you did it with a crew chief that suffered a racing injury last night, Dale.
Yeah, Kevin, he's a monster truck driver, and I think he beat Tony Stewart, but he broke his back as doing it. He broke a vertebrae in his back, but he'll get better by next week, I bet.
Well, congratulations on your win, $1 million, and again, eligible for the million at Las Vegas.
Well, I appreciate it, and all the Good Ranch folks that stand behind us, we appreciate all their support. Grandkids back home, Kelly, my daughter, and Carrie, my son, and all the kids. See you when we go home.
At the beginning of this race, we told you he asked Kevin Hamlin if he won. Kevin said, I did, and so did Earnhardt.
And he gets a big hug and kiss from Teresa. And how about Richard Sturz, 45 years of age from Mount Savage, Maryland? He won $1 million also because he was paired with Dale Earnhardt. Seven-time Winston Cup champion Dale Earnhardt gets his 10th career victory at Talladega Super Speedway. What an effort in those final laps as he was able to sweep by and take the win. Back with more from Talladega in a moment.
A couple of big winners. And
ha ha ha.
Please notice.
Please notice. How about that one? Okay. Be careful, Ned. Travel safe.
See you, Ned.
Back at Talladega, Alabama. Now we can take a deep breath and take a look at the unofficial results today. There were 26 cars finished on the lead lap. Dale Earnhardt the winner. Kenny Wallace equals his best ever career finish. Joe Nemechek third. Jeff Gordon and Terry Labonte rounding up the top five.
Look at Dale Earnhardt Jr. led there just a couple laps ago, finishes 14th. And there you see the 26 cars that did finish in the lead lap. And those four, 27th through 30th, one lap down.
Steve Grissom had a great run going in the Hot Wheels Pontiac, involved in that bumping incident as they crossed the came to the checkered flag, and that cost him a few spots. Take a look at Rick Mast and the Conseco Pontiac finishing a lap down in 31st. As the celebration is ongoing in Victory Lane, the Winston Noble $5 million bills flying around. Now, what about the point standings with four races to go? Earnhardt moves up a spot in front of Jeff Burton, 210 points back of Bobby Labonte. Burton falls back to third. Dale Jarrett is fourth. And Ricky Rudd now moves into fifth spot. And a guy who finished second, equaling his best ever career finish, just standing by with John Kerner.
And Kenny Wallace talking things over with his teammate Joe Nemechek. And Kenny, that close to that first win. Those four tires that you took in the last stop really made a difference, huh?
Yeah, well, how about this? You know, second, third finish for me and Joe. But, you know, I mean, it was just a deal where it was vintage. You know, here I am trying to win the race. And I think I'm trying to get underneath Earnhardt through the tunnel turn, or not tunnel turn, the short shoot here. And he comes down in front of me. And I'm thinking, my God, I have no choice but now to help this guy win and then settle it when we get by there. And I knew better than to hit him going through the trial over here, get him sideways. So I just couldn't believe how much Joe was helping me, and I was just ramming the heck out of Earnhardt. But it was hitting him square. And me and Nemechek won Earnhardt that race. I think he owes us half of that no bull money. But he was thanking us at the end there.
What do you think about that, Joe?
I think we need to get half of that money too. You know, that's we helped push him by. But no, I was helping Kenny there at the end. You know, it's just a good weekend for the whole Andy Petrie Racing team. You know, Oakwood Home Chevy sitting on the pole, finishing third. Kenny finishing second. It's just a good day. I was trying to figure out how to push Kenny by Earnhardt, but he was trying to break the draft. And there was not. If we could add another couple laps, there might have been something, but then the rest of the pack would have been back. So I'm just glad this race is over.
Yeah everybody. Congratulations, guys, back upstairs.
All right, these two guys, teammates finishing second and third. Great day for Andy Petrie Racing, Jerry Vest Engines, and that whole crew. And the celebration is ongoing. Look at all the dollar bills on the ground there. Dollar bills everywhere on the ground in Victory Lane. And how about sheet metal on the racetrack? At the checkered flag wave, the end car slipping and sliding. There comes Steve Grissom, the car number one of Steve Park, and others. Back with more from Talladega in a moment.
Both petty cars were involved.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
All that time he's been trying to get on the record, I only pushed it in. I drove it in.
With Ray, okay. Finished 14th, huh? Okay. The Woodson 500 is history. Take a look at a couple of millionaires there in victory lane. Right of your screen, Earnhardt, and to his immediate right, Richard Sturtz out of Mount Savage, Maryland. Let's check in down on the garage area with Ray.
Well, one Earnhardt stands in victory lane with $1 million, but another one's pretty happy because you had an awesome race car today.
Yeah, we did. It's been a while since we had a car as good as that. We got to lead some laps. I don't know if it's just because everybody else didn't want to, but we was up front for a while and trying to think about how we was, you know, going to run him last two or three laps, and Mike Skinner got up there and mixed it up with us, and I tried to get him on apron. It was now or never, and it was my decision. We probably could have finished in the top five or six if I'd have just kind of rode behind him, but I wanted to win, and we come home 14th. We still happy.
Would you rather have not been the leader there with two to go?
No, I was happy with leading the race, you know, getting some laps, and looking good. I mean, that's what it's all about, no matter where you finish.
Hey, and there's a big group of press around here, and that's good news for Dale Jr.
As I said, he had not had a top 10 finish since the beginning of June, June 4th at Dover, Delaware. Pretty miserable June, July, and August, but what a run he had today. But that won't be the discussion in the Earnhardt House, it'll be this one, another million-dollar winner. Back in a moment. Okay, great. Do we have a...
And I'm with the points leader, Bobby Labonte. Bobby, for a while there, it looked like you might pull off the victory, but at least you got out of here okay, still with a 210-point lead.
Well, that was our goal for the day, finish this thing, and never know what happens. And, you know, the guys did a good job in the pits, good job working on it before we got here. We changed motors this morning because we thought we had something a little bit better with the new plate rule. And, you know, we just rode around there and you know, just watched things, see who was the fastest car. It looked like the A car was the fastest, and I had my eyes set on the back, his back bumper. I thought that would be the place to be. And he made a move on Skinner, I guess it was, there with one to go. He thought it was the last lap, and about that caused a big wreck, and the outside line got us. So we slipped back to 12th, but there's a lot worse things in the world, a lot worse things in this life than finishing 12th today.
As far as the championship goes, four races remaining, are you starting to feel comfortable and in command?
No, never do. I don't think so. I never have yet, I put it that way. I haven't been in this position a whole lot, so. But we do have some races left to go, and you know, we're excited about all of them. We like our chances at every race that we go to, and especially after we got out of here.
All right, a 12th place finish for Bobby Labonte, still leading the points by 210, Jerry.
And you take a look, there were six different positions that changed among the top 10 today, with four events remaining. And we'll have the Winston Cup Series season finale coming your way from Atlanta Motor Speedway, the Napa 500, on November 19th. Back to wrap it up in a moment.
Quabble.
Okay. How much? Winning at Talladega is a tall order. Even at this massive facility, traffic can be treacherous and hitting the wall. And today, Dale Earnhardt had courage, confidence, cooperation, and a whole lot of luck as he takes home the $1 million. For Benny Parsons, Ned Jarrett, John Kernan, Ray Dunlap, and Bill Weber, I'm Jerry Punch. Once again, congratulating the seven-time Winston Cup champion, Dale Earnhardt, on his dramatic win in this 32nd running of the Winston 500. Coming up next, the PGA Las Vegas Invitational. Now let's go out to Roger Twible, and it's a three-way tie. So long, everyone, from Talladega.